thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on Local Gov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Good evening, everyone. We are now in session. I have the honors for tonight, so if everyone will bow their heads. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the protection that you gave President Trump over the weekend. We please bless and be with the families of the family with the individual who was killed, with those that were injured, and please protect everyone. Our Heavenly Father, please guide and direct us. Help everyone realize that hatred has no place in this world. Please guide and direct this meeting, this county, this state, and this nation. We ask that you protect us and lead us throughout our lives in this meeting. Amen. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Mr. Harrison, we expected you to be on the front row leading the pledge. Okay. Madam Clerk, I think we have some amendments to the agenda. Is that correct? You want to adjust item number 7A1?
Yes. You had asked for an agenda adjustment for item 7A1. There are three components of that budget amendment, and we would ask to remove the second one, titled Health Department. It's a budget amendment between the sheriff detention and the health pretrial. We'll bring that back at a later date, so please go ahead and approve items 1 and 3 of that budget amendment. Thank you.
Are there any other amendments to the agenda? There being none, all in favor of this modification, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, that amendment has been made. One of the many, many wonderful opportunities that we have as commissioners is recognizing special people. We have the 2024 NCACC 4-H Youth Voice Delegate in our presence. Would you please step forward, Meredith Lewis? I saw you all dressed up in the hallway. Come on up front, please, right here. And did not know who you are yet. All right. Would you turn around, tell everyone who you are and who you represent, and your age and what grade in school?
I'm just like he's going to give you a microphone.
Well, thank you for having me today. My name is Meriwether Lewis. I'm representing my 4-H community in Alamance County. I'm 14 years old, and I'm going into the ninth grade.
And which school?
At Southeast in Mebane.
Excellent. And what award are you receiving today? You're being recognized by the county commissioners for your achievement as our delegate in, I think it's Winston-Salem, and Miss York is what, 2 weeks?
Yes, for the youth voice.
Right. She knows more about it than I do. So tell everyone what you're doing.
I'm going to the Youth Voice to represent my county, 4-H, and I'm telling my story of what I've done in 4-H and how it's helped me. So we'll see you down there.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
And what happens is the county commissioners go to that convention. We go every year. And she will be our delegate at that convention representing all of Alamance County. So, and do you know this lady right here?
This is my mom.
Okay. turn around and tell everyone who you are.
I'm Meriwether's mom. I'm just here to get a picture.
And to be recognized for having done such a wonderful job. Okay. If we commissioners would stand, and you just stand in front of us, okay. And we're going to do a group picture if you don't mind.
Will you let me just stand next to the character?
Yeah.
Okay. One of the requirements is that she have a picture with the commissioners for the meeting.
She has to speak before the county commissioners meeting, and she's already done that very, very, very well, and then the group picture. Agenda with that one modification. We now need to vote to approve the agenda as amended.
Motion to approve as amended.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Unanimous. Okay. An additional, who do we have here with Parks and Rec, Recreation and Parks?
Do you want us all up?
Absolutely. And I think you and I talked on the phone earlier
today.
Yes,
we did. Yes,
we did. Where's Nolan?
Nolan is on vacation. Sorry.
Who allowed that?
Well, I guess I did technically. I tried to get them to move the meeting so Nolan could be here, but it's not going to happen.
He deserves a vacation. Are you just trying to find out how long you can run without him?
Yeah.
Well, additionally, Bob Baker, who was director of this board for years, is also playing hooky.
Yeah, I don't think he's doing it on purpose, though.
No.
Yeah.
Brian, who's one of our assistant county managers, has an illness which is very, very short, but it has a time limit before he can return. I think you call that code. But in any event, okay, this is the month of July is Parks and Recreation Month.
Correct.
I want to tell a little story before I read this proclamation. Alamance County for years has called it Recreation and Parks. The city of Barnton for years called it Parks and Recreation. And when Mr. Coleman was head of this board and director for many, many, many years, there was a fight going on between him and the Burlington Parks and Rec guy as to which is more important. Recreational parks, and of course we won out. Okay. This proclamation reads, whereas parks and recreation is an integral part of communities throughout the county, including Alamance County, and whereas parks and recreation promotes time spent in nature, which positively impact mental health by increasing cognitive performance and well-being and elevating illness, alleviating illness, such as depression, attention deficit disorders, and Alzheimer's. And whereas parks and recreation encourages physical activities by providing space for popular sports, hiking trails, swimming pools, and many other activities designed to promote active lifestyles. Whereas parks and recreation is a leading provider of health, meals, nutrition services and education, and whereas parks and recreation programming and education activities such as out-of-school time programming, youth sports, and environmental education are critical to the childhood development, and whereas parks and recreation increase a community's economic prosperity through increased property values, expansion of the local tax base, increased tourism, and attract and retention of businesses and crime reduction, and whereas parks and recreation is fundamental to the environmental well-being of our community, and whereas, a lot of whereases, our parks and natural recreation areas ensure the economical beauty of our community and provide a place where children and adults connect with nature and recreate outdoors. And whereas the United States House of Representatives has designated July as Parks and Recreation Month, and whereas Alamance County recognizes the benefits derived from parks and recreation resources, now therefore be it proclaimed by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners that July 2024 will be recognized as Parks and Recreation Month in Alamance County. Is there a motion to that effect?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? I could give you a lot, and what a great job you do.
Absolutely.
Best job in the world.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous. And we're going to present to you a copy of the proclamation. And if you guys will gather here, we're going to stand behind you. And Thomas, if you'll take a picture, we'll break your camera.
Were you guys part of the new playground too?
Yeah, see our new playground.
Yes,
Rock, yeah.
It was amazing.
Thank
Brian
you.
Brian Baker wanted you to think he did. Okay.
All right.
We know better.
Oh, Jason, you're blocking me.
That's
oh.
Fine.
I'm not even there. All right. One, two. Ham's hiding.
I'm good.
Gotcha.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Appreciate you.
Thank you.
Stay right there.
Thank you, sir.
I have a video of Heidi and Brian and Bruce all going down the slide together. If y'all would like to have a copy, I'll give it to you.
Yep.
Thank you for sharing that.
Anytime. I got you.
I have one of those and of Amy, Senator Gailey, and two other ladies at the same time.
Yep.
And for the late parties, oh, no. we just opened a new facility, new park area and so forth, the swing slides, all kinds of brand new and it's accessible for youth, whether handicapped or not. And as Ms. Thompson pointed out, the slide is healthy enough to take three adults at one time. The shorty is shaking her Okay, public comments. The good thing is we only have four. When I call your name, if you will, please, go to the podium, speak into the microphone. You have 3 minutes and direct all of your comments, if you will, to the board. No name calling or anything of that sort. So, okay. Henry Chandler.
Good evening, I'm Henry Chandler, 515 Lewis Graham Road. In August of 2023, this board approved by a vote of 3-2 to endorse a new franchise agreement for Meridian Waste to purchase Cobalt Sandrock. I strongly opposed this vote because the provision in the proposal was to allow trash, primarily construction debris, from 26 counties to be dumped in our southern corridor. The Toyota Battery Magna site in Randolph County is only 12 miles from this landfill. It doesn't take an accomplished genius to understand why Meridian was so interested in this landfill. I can't possibly calculate the tons of trash this construction site will generate. I want to publicly thank the two commissioners that voted against this proposal. I can't call you by name. My feelings were best expressed by an opposing commissioner that was published in Alamance News, and I quote, "I don't know how it is prudent to take people's garbage from 20 counties away and stick it in my county. That is not what our county should be doing," end quote. There's nothing I can add to that, but now I get to my main point. This is my point. With the recent property tax increase, this old wound was reopened. I feel moved to address this topic in person because two previous attempts to get more information from this board on the Meridian deal was ignored. Meridian laid out strong financial carrots to gain the needed votes. I am going to make a reasonably safe bet that no one in this county is following up on the promises they made a year ago. They are as follows. Host fee of $1 per ton into the county's general fund for every ton of waste it accepts. Promised an annual payout of at least $50,000 during the first 12 months, regardless of how much trash is dumped. They would increase this amount, $25,000 a year minimum, until it reaches a plateau of $100,000 by year three. It is not too much to ask of this board and staff to make sure financial promises are being realized before you increase taxes to property owners. So my question is, are you? I know how things like this get dropped in county government. I totally understand how it happens. You have my address, you got my email, you got my phone number. I would like to have an answer to my question. Please, don't ignore me this time. Thank you.
And sir, this is out of procedure for me, and I apologize to this board, but if you will stay, I will give you the telephone number for a hive in Meridian. They called me this past week and asked me how things were going with the trash and whatever, so I will give you that individual's number so you can talk directly to her.
Is there, I'm sorry, Mr. Paisley, is there someone in the county I could talk to as well to be sure this is being taken care of?
Ms. York, who should be talked to?
I'm happy to handle it.
Okay.
Call Ms. York.
I'll get in touch with Ms. York. Thank you.
All right. And I will give you that telephone number.
I'll wait for it.
All right. Thank you. Mr. Fortner. We'll hear from you again shortly.
That's true. Good evening, Commissioners. I'm Jackie Fortner. I'm from Snow Camp, North Carolina. Or wherever else the sheriff sends me. The sheriff cannot be here tonight. I'm speaking on behalf of him. As you know, he's on vacation this week with his family, but he does not leave his phone behind, and he works even when he's on vacation. He has received numerous phone calls and wants to encourage the Board of Commissioners to please don't have any ideas about ever selling alcohol or letting somebody sell alcohol or possess alcohol on any of our county parks or any of our county trails that we have in Alamance County. These are for our children. These are for good things to happen, not to be faced with what our children and stuff is today. He is very much against this. He didn't have to talk long to me till I knew he was very upset after the phone calls that he has filtered today. So please, he's begging you, along with other citizens, and to my understanding, quite a few citizens today have called him and called him over the weekend about, please do not ever allow alcohol to be sold at any events that are on county property or county parks, and to not even possess it, even on our trails that we have, the Hall River Trail, any of that stuff. And that's what I'm here today to let you know his feelings, which is along with the Sheriff's Office feelings and every member of the Sheriff's Office, and to the city's citizens that we represent in this county. Thank you all so much.
Thank you. Mr. Harrison.
Thank you. Commissioners, my name is Leonard Harrison. I live at 3161 Fieldstone Lane in Mebane, North Carolina. I'm coming up here out of absolute frustration. After our last meeting that you guys had, we had the school board asking for more money, saying this is what we needed, this will make us happy if you guys do this, this, and this. Since that time, they're now coming with Graham Middle School, saying, oh, by the way, we need millions for Graham Middle School. Now, at any point, they've given you, in multiple points, they've given you, these are our top 10s, these are our top 20s, these are the things that we need. As citizens in this county, we expect you guys to let us know, this is the tax rate, this is the funds that are going out, this is the budget for the coming year. And every time we turn around, over the past 6 years, through two different directors over there at Alamance Burlington School System, we've had, oh, well, we forgot about this. Oh, wait a minute, we didn't know about that. It is coming to the point where we have to wonder whether it's either gross negligence, gross ignorance, or willful malicious intent to deceive the board as of commissioners on what is going on over there. So we expect you guys to live up to the past and take care of our children, because it's important that our school systems be manned and taken care of at a level that is decent and everything, so that the kids can make sure that when they graduate, they are educated, they are literate, they can do math, and by George, they can get employed, because not everybody goes to college. So that school might be their only schooling they ever go to. But we turn around and we ask the taxpayer again and again and again, make sure that you're out there telling them how bad the county commissioners are. But it's not the county commissioners who are deceiving the public. It's not the county commissioners who are deceiving the school system. It's the Board of Education over there that has decided time and time again to go, we're going to hold this back. We're not going to let them know about this. We're going to say these things are important, and then go and have news conferences and say, hey, look, now we want to be all on the same page. We want to do everything the same. We want you guys to come to the table with a good feeling of what's going on here in the county and in the school system. As soon as that meeting's over, got them again, buddy, and they can't do a thing about it. And I'm really getting fed up with it from the taxpayer side of the thing, going, well, now I know next year they're going to have to raise my taxes again because they've left out this, this, and this, and they've deceptively done it so that when it comes down to the thing, they can paint you guys as the bad guys when that is not the case or even close to it, because they're deceiving every single aspect here. They're deceiving the teachers, saying, hey, by George, we're trying to get a teacher raise. Oh, by the way, we raised the administration more than we raised you guys. And it's just absolutely deplorable what's going on, and I'm fed up with it. Y'all have a great day. Enjoy, and God bless Alamance County and America.
Thank you. The next name, and I'll apologize in advance, Jose. You're going to have to spell your name for me, please, sir.
Sure.
And I apologize.
Good evening, County Commissioners, Alamance residents. My name is Jose Molina, spelled J-O-S-E, Molina, M-O-L-I-N-A. I am on 413 Hallelone Lane in Burlington. I'm here to advocate for 21,000 residents, Alamance residents, that have been forgotten for at least the last three, if not four, previous administrations. It is very sad and shameful to see pictures of collapsed roofs, school roofs, as they're being repaired, that could have fallen on our students in Adams County. Local officials who have blood on their hands. Thankfully, that didn't happen. But why wait for a catastrophe to happen when we can prevent those things and prevent the loss of lives? With this being said, I have asked one of the principals at the school and also the central office personnel, who is in charge for looking for hazards, preventions on repairs, or who inspects the schools that needs upgrades and repairs. The principal's answer and the central office answer was everyone, everybody. You all know that if everybody is in charge, that means no one is in charge and no one will be responsible. That answer explains to me the reasons on why our school buildings are awful, unsafe, unhealthy, and the reasons on why we have to spend millions of dollars on mold repairs. Alamance County cannot rely on students or teachers or administrators to report the needed maintenance or life-threatening hazards that only experts can see before it's too late. I have mentioned this to the school board, and I have to mention it to you today. Our school buildings, they need to be inspected at least once a year, just as the fire marshal comes in every 6 months and inspects our buildings for fire hazards. I have recommended to the board, so I recommend it to you. This will not be an expense. This will be an insurance policy for the taxpayers, and also it will be an investment. So that way we don't have to spend millions of dollars repairing what could cost a lot less. And this also will provide a safer, better maintained campuses and healthy environment for 21,000 plus students and teachers. The second thing I want to bring up is the excuse that you have given to raise property taxes is not acceptable. Number one, where are the allocated taxes that were supposed to be invested in our school buildings for the last 10 years? We have not seen those things. Number two, the growth of the county that we go into. One of your staff members have said, for example, one of the staff members have said, we're growing like crazy. Doesn't that mean that we are bringing in more income revenue? God bless Alamance County. Really appreciate it.
Sir, before you sit down, we will address your issue at the end of this meeting. So encourage you to sit around, hang on with us. I mean, it's going to be probably longer than we would like and or you would like. But we will address that issue, but we cannot do so at this point.
Okay.
Thank you. That's the last one. Okay, consent agenda. We have a modification, and we deleted one item, 7A1.
Motion to approve is amended.
I'll second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Okay, so that takes us to 7B at this point. 7A1 being moved off the agenda.
B.
Did you move everything at 7A?
I did not, sir. I was asking for the second piece of that budget amendment to come off, but for the first and third to go ahead and move forward.
Okay. And that's the consent agenda. Any discussion about the consent agenda? Do I have a motion to approve the consent agenda? All right, I second. All in favor, signify by saying aye. Any opposed? Unanimous. Okay, public hearing. We have two. Do I have a motion to open a public hearing on the bulletin budget amendment school capital projects fund? And Mr. Hart, why don't you go ahead and speak before we open that?
Is this item eight on the agenda, or is this
Item number 9.
Excuse me, 8A.
Yes, sir. Just to clarify, so this is the public hearing for the historic landmarks?
Correct.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Commissioners. Tonight, I am presenting you with two historic landmark resolutions for sites which are eligible for official historic designation within the county. The first is the Guthrie Mill Dam in the Snow Camp community. And the second is the Oak Grove Slave Cemetery within the village of Alamance. Both of these sites have gone through the proper processes to make them eligible historic landmarks. This process has included submitting a complete application to the Planning Department, undergoing evaluation from the North Carolina Department of Natural and Cultural Resources, a public hearing before the county's Historic Properties Commission, and ultimately the HPC's review and approval. State law also requires that you host a public hearing tonight before taking any action on these resolutions. I'll also note that in state law, a public hearing notice did run twice in the Alamance News. Since these are two separate landmark designations, I would recommend that you open the floor separately once for each, and I'll certainly be glad to give a summary of each item before you take action on those items. And so, are we officially in public hearing now?
We have not voted yet.
So I'll be glad to give a summary, or if you want to open it for comments.
Why don't you go ahead and give the summary for the school capital project fund. Excuse me. For the
Guthrie Dam
Bill Historic Landmark.
Yes, sir. Thank you. So the first landmark is known as the Guthrie Dam Mill. This dam is located on the property at 7855 Mack Lane in Snow Camp. This dam is believed to have been constructed during the late 1800s, approximately 1873, and built in a style that ended around the end of the 19th century. Dams of this style powered grist mills and often operated some 8 to 10 hours per day. This historical designation would apply only to the immediate 50-foot area surrounding the dam. In the picture there, it's the blue shaded area. This is roughly 22,000 square feet on the property. It would not apply to the entire property. And Mr. Chairman, I do have a few pictures that I could share with you in addition to this one, if you would like.
Please do that.
Yes, sir. So photo one here is just an overhead aerial image of the property. As you can see, as I mentioned, the blue shaded area is really the only particular area of the property that's up for historical designation. The initial application featured the entire property, but the home that is on the property was either constructed or located to the property after the dam was built. So after the state of North Carolina's Department of Cultural Resources reviewed the application, they said it's probably best just to focus on the dam, and that's why the specific area there is shaded in blue. This is the face wall of the dam, photo two here. This is a broader overview of the property. I have no idea who those two fine people are evaluating the property. And then these are two photos of the same mill pond, which is just outside of the specific area of the dam. But these would be encompassed in the 50-foot radius that's specifically up for designation. I'll finish with this. The resolution before you does a few important things. Number one, it specifies the area of the property which is being recognized and details the historic significance of the site. Number two, it verifies that all legal procedures have been complied with for the designation. And number three, it establishes a requirement that if any significant changes are to be made to the landmark, then a certificate of appropriateness will need to be applied for through the county first. And with that, I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.
I understand that the stones themselves were actually cut and then floated down the river to construct this facility. Is that correct?
You know, I'm not sure about that in particular, but I wouldn't be surprised. I've learned a good deal about dams and grist mills in this whole process. I still have a lot to learn, but I wouldn't be surprised. I do know that based on the documentation, a gentleman named George Guthrie, who was a well-known millwright at the time, along with a workman named Richard Freeman, apparently built the dam in 1873. As to the particulars of the construction, that might be a little bit beyond my scope of knowledge.
Was Mr. Carter present?
I was pretty much out of diapers by that time.
And notice I didn't mention me. any other historical significance about this project? And so it's one of the early textile mills in the county.
Is that right? Yeah. In terms of the summary of the project, I think that's really the highlights of the historical significance. We did have some neighbors show up during the Historic Properties Commission's public hearing on this property. They asked about increased traffic or a plaque or an official landmark on the property. The property owner is not really interested in any sort of official landmark, but the state general statute that gives guidance on these issues does allow for one if one wants to be placed earlier. So they don't. This is a private road. They don't anticipate any additional traffic up and down the road, but they would have the option for a historic landmark later.
Do we have a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved. Second.
Motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous. Okay. Anyone on this side of the room want to make any comments regarding this particular piece of property? Yes, sir.
Did he say it was on a private road?
Yes, sir. That's correct.
So,
yeah,
I mean,
come
would
on
we,
down,
be, would we have access to it or?
I mean, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So, in general, you know, the public has access to private roads.
Private.
Okay. The designation of whether or not a road is public or private really just comes down to who maintains it. So it is privately maintained by the individuals who live along the road in the neighborhood. I don't know the particulars of any sort of an agreement, but it's very common for private roads to have like a road maintenance committee or a voluntary association that provides for regular maintenance of usually a gravel road. Yeah, you've probably accidentally driven down and had to turn around many private roads.
Oh, they have.
Over the years.
Extra question. Anything else? Anybody else on this side? Anyone on this side of the room? Do we have a motion to close the public hearing as to this portion?
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor, signify by saying
aye.
Just public hearing.
Okay, yeah, I was just going to ask Matt, if is the sign courtesy of the county or courtesy of the state?
That's an excellent question. We don't right now in the planning department have a specific item in our budget for signs. In speaking with Brian Baker about this coming up on tonight's agenda, he recommended that we take a look at, for next year's budget season, maybe allocating a little bit of money for sign purposes for these types of landmarks throughout the county. With this one and with the next one, I'm not sure that the county's involvement in the sign is going to be of particular importance. Like I said, the property owner is someone applied on behalf of the property owned the property. The property owner did not initiate this application, so I'm not sure that he is particularly interested in the sign. And then the next one, as you'll see, is within the town limits of the village of Alamance. So I don't know that the signs are going to be a major issue on these, but we have talked about in the future making sure that there's funding for future signs.
I just think this is going to be honored as a historical place. It needs to be acknowledged. Of course, that's somebody's private land, so to speak.
Yeah,
they need their permission.
And the resolution has to be recorded with the Register of Deeds and shared with the tax office and shared with the building inspector and the immediate property owners. And I think that there's a mechanism in GIS to designate it there as well. So it will be designated even if there's not a sign specifically on the property.
Okay.
Anything else as in the public hearing portion? We have a motion and a second to get out of the public hearing. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? We're no longer in the public hearing. Mr. Stevens,
sir.
I would ask that you and Ms. York, county attorney, county manager, at least look into the cost and what would be required as to that and bring it back to us at a future date.
Understood.
Board agree? All right. Thank you. Okay, the second matter. We're not going to let you escape. Yes, sir.
If I may, I've got a question for Mr. Hogan on this. You said that someone other than the property owner applied for this?
Yes, sir.
Does the property owner have to consent to the application?
Yes.
So the property owner is fine with this designation?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
And the applicant was actually an HPC board member, Ms. Catherine Hadley.
Okay.
I think her distant relatives actually constructed the dam, which is why she had a particular interest in it, but she had the consent of the property owner.
She was my 8th grade science teacher.
Is
she's
that right?
Amazing. Oh, I love her.
She's great. She's very knowledgeable.
She is.
Board, any other questions or statements? Okay. I don't know if you would go to item number two.
Mr. Chair, I think you need to vote on that one first.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
All in favor, I'll make the motion to have this designated as a landmark designation Do I have a second?
I'll second.
All right. Any further discussion? All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Unanimous. Thank you, Mr. Stevens. Okay, the Oak Grove Slave Cemetery Historical Landmark Resolution is next.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. So this second resolution before you, this historic landmark designation actually comes at the request of the Village of Alamance. The Oak Grove Slave Cemetery is believed to be the final resting place of between 14 and 40 enslaved African Americans. It is located actually on a vacant parcel found at parcel ID 172464, which is along Yorkshire Drive in the Heritage Glen neighborhood. According to the report, the formerly enslaved people's accomplishments include establishing Springdale AME Church, establishing one of the first schools to train African American teachers in the community, helping with the development and dyeing of original Alamance plaid design, being appointed as the county's first black deputy sheriff, and efforts to quell KKK activities in the area by giving testimony to the United States Senate. I also have pictures of this property, Mr. Chairman, I'll be glad to share as well. So, like the previous consideration, this is simply a GIS aerial image of the property. As I mentioned, it is a vacant property. I'm not sure when exactly this photo was taken, but it was included in the application packet. The sign there says Oak Grove Slave Cemetery. There's a modest rock wall around the immediate area of where the graves are believed to be. And I think this was done by the Boy Scouts or an Eagle Scout a number of years ago, just in an effort to kind of engage in some landscaping and clean up the property. This is a photo from a ground-penetrating radar survey, which was performed by a firm called New South Associates in September of 2014. And this is not a great image, but this is more or less an aerial image with an overlay of what are believed to be evidence of the remnants of 14 specific grave sites. This was included in their report that they put together in October of 2014, so just about 10 years ago now. Like the previous resolution, this one does three important things. Number one, it specifies the property which is being recognized and details the historic significance. Number two, it verifies that all legal procedures have been complied with for designation. And number three, it establishes that if any significant changes are to be made to the landmark, then a certificate of appropriateness will be needed and applied for through the county. I'll just make mention, too, that since the Village of Alamance does not have a Historic Properties Commission, they rely upon the county's Historic Properties Commission to evaluate these types of properties. So, again, happy to take any questions you might have.
Where exactly is this development? Is it beyond E.M. Holt School? Or?
It's very near to there. I'm not sure if you can pull up an aerial image of the GIS. I think it's within a mile or so northwest of the school. It's in the Heritage Glen subdivision.
So you go through the Village of Alamance, make the right-hand 90-degree turn to the right, and it's just beyond E.M. Holt. Is that correct?
That sounds correct, yeah. Like I said, it is inside the town limits or the village limits of the Village of Alamance.
Yeah, I think it actually adjoins the property for Heritage Glen, doesn't it?
It's within the Heritage Glen subdivision. Yeah, there are... It borders two, to the north, it borders two properties which have just standard residential lots. And then there's actually a vacant property immediately to the south. So it's in a little bit of a tucked away corner of the neighborhood, you might say. The parcel ID is 172464.
While you're looking, is there any way to identify the names of those folks that are buried there?
That's an excellent question. I don't know that they... identified the names of any individuals that are believed to be buried there. The report that they submitted in the application did talk about how these were slaves on the Holt property, and that the descendants of the slaves who are believed to be buried there, many of them kept the Holt name, as was common in the time, and went on to, like, the property says, for example, Caswell Holt helped to dye the original Alamance plaid design, which became the first commercially produced colored cotton fabric made in the American South.
Yeah, there's a long history about the Holtz with the Fabersons. I'm just curious if you mentioned a church. Spring what?
Springdale A&E.
Do they have possibly a Bible that would have, you know, our family Bibles have family history in it. I didn't know if there was some kind of way. I just think it would be really nice if we knew who was there to honor them with some kind of signage, because I doubt they have bookmarkers
sure.
or anything like that.
And I'll mention, too, that so the property is currently owned by the Homeowners Association of the neighborhood. The Village of Alamance has told us that they're in conversations with the Homeowners Association to acquire the property and build it out into more of a significant, you know, maybe like a park or like a commemorative site. So according to their report that they submitted, the cemetery design exists in a similar condition as possible to what was originally established. There are no known photographs of the gravesite, so it's difficult to replicate the original with any certainty. Consequently, they have preserved the site to what the regional norms are for burial during the time. No official memorial is currently established at the site. The Village of Alamance is working with the Alamance County Historic Museum and our engineers to create a memorial site plan. Currently, there's a small wooden sign that identifies the Oak Grove Slave Cemetery. And then they go on to say that our expectation is to have the property designated as a historic site. We hope to create a small parking area and a small memorial near the ceremony with a narrative that describes what this site is and how the descendants of these slaves affected the regional development of North Carolina.
And I think in the materials that you provided, which they had several first names for some of the grave sites. But first names have been indicated that after slavery was demolished, they took the last name of Holt.
Yes, sir.
Have they marked the graves that they found in any way by the ground radar?
I think that there are more or less, they talk about, they talk about some sort of marking in the report. Slave burial sites often lack proper headstones or markers. I don't know that they're marked, but they do talk about an ornamental ivy called vinca vines that are found growing over the suspected grave sites, and apparently that was common as a relatively simplistic memorialization for these types of burial sites.
Any other discussion before we go into the public hearing?
The Homeowners Association owns the property?
Yes, sir.
And they have, did they submit the request?
The Village of Alamance submitted the request.
And the Homeowners Association has approved?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other questions? I'll move that we go into the public hearing. So I have a second.
I'll second.
All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any dissent? No. So it's unanimous, approved. Looking at your notes, and these pages are not named or numbered, but you do have as part, and this is in the public information, which is online, you have the name Jim, Jude, Rose, and just several, looks like 10, 15 names. After some of the names, you have 1845, 1838, 1832, different designations. The name Hester, 1841, and three children, so apparently one common area. And so there's more material that's on our line with the public county commissioner's packet.
Yes, sir. And that's documentation that we'll hang on to in the planning department as well. So if anyone is interested, they want to email us for copies of these documents, we'll be glad to provide them.
Thank you. Any comments on this side of the room? You volunteered before? No.
No, you covered it when you got the dates.
Okay.
I was wondering about the dates.
Okay. but they say they go from the late 70s through the mid 1800s. So, anyone on this side of the room? Do we have a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
Motion second. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It's unanimous. Okay. Now we need to discuss this landmark resolution. Do we have a motion?
I like a motion that we go ahead and approve it. We've already discussed it.
I'll second it. Any further discussion?
You know, Ancestry.com, Ancestry, all these things, they solve everything like that. Everybody comes from somebody. Mm-hmm. And I would love to find out the history of this, because their relatives, just like all of our relatives, could still be in this county. And I think it would be really cool to have them to be part of this somehow.
Coincidentally, this past week, I spent some time going through my grandfather's Bible that I hadn't seen. My sister brought it up to me, and that was an interesting experience, looking at the names that are in there, looking at all the scripture that had been marked.
Ms. Thompson, are you volunteering to do the research?
I don't want us to all be in our 90s by the time I finish it. I just think that's really special. I just don't want us to say, hey, they're there, HOA, all this stuff. It's just too important. And I know there's a Bible somewhere that's got all this in it, because folks back then, that was their records, and they're pretty exact. So just something to think about.
Thank you. Okay, we have a motion, a second, and we voted on it.
Thank you.
All in favor?
All in favor of the motion? Signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? It passes. Thank you for both parties.
Thank you, Commissioners. Have a nice evening.
Thank you.
Matt, why don't you put Rodney Cheek on this? Rodney Cheek would be perfect.
He's the chairman of the HBC.
He needs something.
Thank you.
Okay, next item is 9A, budget amendment by school capital project fund. That initially was on our consent agenda, and I asked to be placed on as an agenda item simply because some of the verbiage is confusing and easy to misunderstand. So, Ms. Evans, would you explain this item?
Absolutely. Good evening, Commissioners. Before you tonight is a request for us to amend our school's capital project fund by $19,515,388.83. This is a result of the 24 general obligation bond sale, if the board will recall, that took place back in May. We've received those funds. This will allocate the funds for the various HVAC and roofing needs that we have talked about earlier, as well as reallocating some funds from the 2021 bond sale from Pleasant Grove, Williams High School, and Southeast High School to the Smith Elementary project for the HVAC needs.
All right. Just so, because one of the speakers particularly was talking about projects and so forth, would you read the location of these projects?
Absolutely, Commissioners. So what we're looking at doing is completing projects at Hall River Elementary, B. Everett Jordan Elementary, Western Middle, Western High, Eastern High, South Mebane Elementary, Southern Middle, Alexander Wilson Elementary, Hillcrest Elementary, and Smith Elementary. If the board will remember, when we had the various HVAC and roofing projects that we had evaluated, what staff looked at was to be able to maximize as much of those funds as we possibly could. In working with ABSS, Greg Cook was able to identify where there were additional monies left over from the 21 bond sale. So what we were able to do, let's say if a project needed $1.7 million, as Western High School did for their HVAC, what we're looking to do is reduce that by the amount that we had in the project savings. I don't have that right here, so the number I have in front of me. What we had available for Western High School was $10,162. So we adjusted those prices so that we could maximize the bond monies. Also, due to being in the bond premium market that we are in, the principal amount was reduced so that the county would not receive more than $19.515 million from the initial bond sale. We received proceeds of $19,514,423.95. And then once that good faith deposit was made by the purchaser of the bonds, we earned an interest of $964.88. So that's what brings our total allotment, this what we're asking to be allocated, to $19,515,388.83.
And these monies are for this ABSS school system?
Yes, sir.
And it's part of the bond that was passed in 2018?
That is correct.
All right. And the school system could have asked that these bonds be sold earlier, but chose to delay this actual sale of the bonds. Is that correct? They could have done it in 2019, 2020.
So when the original bonds were sold, the board that was in place at that time only voted for us to receive cash of $150 million. So what that created was authorized but unissued bonds, which is what the county commissioners authorized us to continue to move forward with the May 29th bond sale.
All right, now, if you look on page 148 in the agenda, which is page 2 on this item, it talks about a bond premium. And my question to you was, we did not approve the premium, and you indicated?
So with us being in the bond premium market, you have to accept some portion of premium. You cannot do a par bond sale. So what we were able to do, staying within the parameters that the first resolution that was approved for us to move forward with the bond sale, was not to exceed a principal amount of $19.5 million. What I did was I adjusted that principal amount down so that we did not issue more debt, that we would receive cash that was at the $19.5 million. It was slightly below the $19.515 million. We received the $19,514,000.
So to keep all the numbers correct as to what the county commissioners had approved, you had to show the bond premium but reduced the actual amount of the proceeds themselves.
That is correct, Commissioner Paisley. So instead of seeing a bond sale proceeds of $19,515,000, the budget amendment that we're requesting is to budget proceeds of $18,145,000.
So it all comes out even and follows what the taxpayers allowed us to do.
With the vote of the board.
All right. Do I have a motion as to this item?
Motion to approve.
I do have one question.
I'll second it, but go ahead.
Yeah, it'll be a very easy question. I see you have these schools listed here with a figure to the right. Will the commissioners get, for example, Hall River Elementary? I have a real question about that because I see it on the list of having something done to that school for like the last 20 years. I'm exaggerating for effect. It's not quite that much, but are we going to get at least an idea of what projects are going to be taken care of, for example, the Western High?
Absolutely. So that was in a previous handout that the board received. So for Hall River Elementary, that $200,000 is going to go for the HVAC projects. So I'll be glad to email that list out to the commissioners again. And then we'll also receive updates at our monthly OSC meetings.
Thank you. I just wanted you to say that loud. I haven't. I just wanted you to say that loud.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other questions?
One quick question, Mr. Chairman, Ms. Evans. This vote would put the $19.5 million into ABSS's capital projects fund.
That is correct.
Which would allow them to obtain contracts immediately.
Yes, sir.
Do we know if they, do we know what the status of their effort to obtain contracts on these, for this work is?
I have not asked Greg Cook that, but I can find that out.
That'd be good to know. I'd hope that they would work some in advance so that once we reach this point that they would be ready to move on these.
Yes.
That would be good.
Is this the 19th that puts us over the 150?
When you're talking cash-wise, that was absolutely received, yes, ma'am. But we are staying within the $150 million of principal amount that the voters approved to issue.
Which is why she had to adjust the bond premium.
Yeah, that premium.
The premium.
But are we paying for over $150 million?
We are paying for slightly below $150 million worth of principal. We will pay a little bit higher of an interest rate due to the bond premium, but as far as the par principal amount that was issued, we have not exceeded the $150 million that was approved by voters in November of 2018.
It's the total amount we borrowed.
Yes.
Now, what is the total amount?
The total amount, bear with me just a minute. I don't have that figure right here in front of me. Bear with me just a minute. Sorry, commissioners.
That's the real question.
Bear with me just a minute.
And while she's doing that, so you don't have to sit through the entire meeting, this board, county commissioners, have really pushed hard to get the ABSS, the school system, the school board members, the administration. You know, we keep setting monies aside for them. Southern High School and Graham High School both, by 2022, had set aside $5 million for each of those schools, $10 million. And they finally entered contracts on, I guess, Graham High School. I'm not even sure they've entered contracts yet on Southern High School. So we can give them the money. We cannot, as county commissioners, make them spend it or make them spend it in a timely fashion.
So, commissioners, in answer to the question, how much principal has been issued to date for ABSS, we have issued $148,630,000.
What's the total amount of principal and par?
Principal and par is $169,164,791.15.
Okay.
That does not include ACC?
That does not include ACC.
Thank you.
It's totally improper for me to ask you this. Did that answer your question?
Well, I had one point that the 3 minutes didn't give me, but I'm not asking to give them a blank check, okay, so they can do whatever they want.
Let me clarify that. We don't give them a blank check.
Yes, we do.
Well,
with all due respect.
Give them monies for improvements, and they really have dragged their feet dramatically.
That's why I believe on a government that will be governed. You know, this is 21,000 Alamance residents that don't vote yet, and they might not even know what's going on, but we adults, we know. And that's why I asked to give them, okay, here's the money to do the project,
yeah,
but give them a deadline.
Well, I was just gonna suggest that you asked a good question earlier that everybody that's watching needs to know this. A Board of Health director is sitting right over there. Alamance County taxpayers pay to have each and every school inspected each and every year. And they give the ABSS, they give them a list of things that are wrong with that particular school and even show them how to fix it. Now, the reason I want to answer that question is because you had a very good question to ask. Who is responsible for making sure that someone puts some eyes on those schools? Our Board of Health does it each and every year and hands it to the principal of that school. If you want to go see whatever school that you're interested in, you can go to our website, our government website, and you can type in each and every school in our system. I think there's 38,
yeah,
maybe 37.
38 campuses, yeah.
You can go check them out. 37. And you can go actually take this physical copy with you to the school board meeting and ask them, why aren't you fixing this school?
Perfect.
Because they know what is going on with those schools, and we gave them $60 million this year to maintain and operate the school. Now, we can help, and we're going to try to help. Why are the taxpayers of Alamance County paying for jobs? 121. That money should be going to fix the schools and not paying teachers, nurses, whatever the case may be, because that's not what we're obligated to do. On the night of our budget, we had our manager, county manager, read to everybody what we are responsible to do. And I would suggest that you go look at it, because if you're a taxpayer of Alamance County, it's affecting you.
Thank you.
You had a good question.
Thanks.
Chairman Paisley, this is exactly why Steve and I suggested we do our board responses back to the public comments immediately after they do theirs.
Absolutely.
So they don't have to sit through this painstaking meeting when they only come to get a certain question answered. And I'd like for us to revisit that sometimes, because when you come here, you want to know, and that's why you come here. And I just really would like for us to think of it, because you don't want to sit here the whole time and not comment when it's really something that's real passionate to somebody. Like the gentleman on the back about trash, and this gentleman here, thank you for coming. You got to step up for your kids and stuff. You just do. So I think we might want to think about that at another meeting, that we can reply back to folks that come in here so they can get on with their business, and then we can move on with the meeting as well.
Yeah.
You might want to be aware.
Explanation is this. We were having 4 and 5 hour meetings. We changed the procedure so that county commissioners, and I was out of line when I recognized you. You should not have done that. But
I wasn't doing that to say that. I'm just thinking we need to think about that again.
It's not about it.
Yeah. Well, Ms. Thompson is right. It would be much easier for us to comment immediately. Because a lot of times people just get up and leave and don't listen to the end of the meeting. Okay.
I'd like to make a comment too,
yes.
Mr. Chairman. If you follow what happened between the Board of Commissioners and ABSS last year, there was a time at which ABSS went on live TV and made an accusation that the county commissioners were not funding the needs of the schools. At the same time, now they mentioned 7 schools that were having roof and HVAC problems. At the same time, they were sitting on the funding we had already provided, some of it almost 3 years old, to cover those needs, and they hadn't even engaged a contractor. That's what Chair Paisley, I believe, mentioned just a minute ago. Almost $11.5 million had been provided, and they hadn't even engaged a contractor. And they were saying that we weren't funding them. I've said this before, so it's not new. Their finances over there are a train wreck. I've had that conversation with the current interim superintendent and with the current chair and with other board members over there. They realize that, because they realize right now they don't even know what the actual financial situation is over there as of the meeting we had at the end of June. I don't know if they've any have reconciled that yet or not, but they still don't know what the true status of their finances are right now. It's a mess.
In other words, you need to be talking to the ones in charge, i.e. school board.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
And the school board needs to actually be in charge.
Yeah.
They're not.
Call for a question, Mr. Chair.
All right. Everyone in favor of 9A, budget amendment, indicate same by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed?
I cannot support that, because I swore I would not pay back over $150. I'm the biggest support the school system has. But I've said this from the beginning, and I'm going to stick by it. I wish I won the lottery. I'd fix it all myself. But I just got to stick by what I initially said.
Okay, it's 4-1 vote. Thank you. Okay, opioid settlement, item number 9B. Please do. Thank you.
Good evening, Commissioners. Thank you for the opportunity to come before you this evening. My name is Ashley Barber, and tonight I will be providing you with an opioid settlement request for application update. Tonight's agenda, we're going to look at the request for application process, the RFA funding recommendations, some additional recommendations that we have. I'm going to provide you with the post-overdose response detailed budget. This is just informative only. There's no action for that this evening. As well as the opioid settlement financial overview and our next steps. So following our March 18th meeting, we began to solicit applications for the following strategies: evidence-based addiction treatment, recovery support services, recovery housing support, early intervention, and reentry programs. We held our bidders conference on March the 27th, and the deadline to receive applications was on May the 1st. We did receive 12 applications. Two of those applications were incomplete and not eligible for review. The additional 10 applications that were eligible, they were reviewed and scored by three different review committee members for each application. And so based on those application scores, we have the following funding recommendations. Strategy 2, evidence-based addiction treatment. Residential Treatment Services of Alamance, better known to some as RTSA. The total funding amount is $599,999, and that is to implement a medication-assisted treatment program in addition to their existing services. Strategy 3, Recovery Support Services. Residential Treatment Services of Alliance, to expand and enhance integrated recovery support services focusing on care coordination for individuals transitioning from detox or treatment back into the community. The total funding amount for this strategy is $360,295.80. Strategy 6 is Early Intervention. The funding recommendation is for Crossroads Sexual Assault Response and Resource Center. This funding will support a portion of the salaries for the staff who provide immediate access and trauma-informed treatment for children and adolescents who have experienced trauma and may be struggling with problematic use of substances or mental health conditions. The total funding amount is $119,899.20. And for Strategy 12, Reentry Programs, Benevolence Farm. To support their reentry program, these funds will support the salary of a full-time peer support specialist on staff, transportation for their program participants to treatment, and their Housing First Fund. This funding will help formerly incarcerated individuals with opioid addiction to secure housing. The total funding amount is $117,654.50. For these four strategies, the total recommended funding amount is $1,197,848.50.
I just want to say something to you. Thank you. You have worked your butt off for so many years, and I know you had some resistance when you first started, but girl, you have killed it, and I'm so proud of you, and I'm so thankful for what you're doing. It's so needed. Okay, go.
I agree.
A girl is Kristen Powers. I'm sorry.
So the additional, one thing that you will notice is on that previous slide is there was not a recommendation to solicit application or a funding recommendation for recovery housing support. We did receive one application. However, the review committee felt that we, because of this being such an urgent matter and such an issue that needed really to be addressed more immediately, the plan for implementation was a bit longer. With a lot of funding before activities actually began. So the recommendation is that we go back to the drawing board again and we open it back up for applications on August the 1st, keeping the funding amount the same, the $224,000 over 2 years. And so then we have some additional recommendations. So for county-operated or implemented programs, we did not require them to participate through the RFA process as they are part of the county. So we are recommending 1 year funding for the following strategies. Strategy 1 is collaborative strategic planning, and this is going to be funding to support the salary and fringe benefits for county personnel who dedicate at least 50% of their time to support this, to support opioid planning, coordination, implementation, monitoring of services, and programs related to the opioid settlement and opioid remediation activities. That amount is $45,013.77. Under strategy 3, recovery support services, this would be to fund Family Justice Center, $40,000 to support their ongoing partnership to provide on-site therapy and peer support services. You all are very aware that their funding has decreased, like many organizations, and we have supported them to be able to have these services through our crisis MOE dollars. And so we took that into consideration when they made their request for funding.
Ashley, is that an outside provider or is that RHA doing that on-site mental health?
It's actually Orinoco Wellness, if I'm saying that
correctly.
Yeah,
okay.
That is who that they've been contracting with for about the last year. We will work with them as far as the data collection to really look at how many of these individuals are experiencing issues with opioid use disorder, and what services that they need ongoing. And then strategy 12 is reentry programs. This is for transportation funding for individuals who have been recently incarcerated to be transported to treatment services. This would be for individuals who are working with the pretrial services team, our peer support specialist, and our recovery coordinator. And transportation would be arranged through them through a contracted transportation provider. And the funding amount for that is $20,000.
Now, if they're out of county, does that still count? Because I had several in Wayne County. Or is that just local?
So we're still exploring the contract itself, but this would be to take them within North Carolina and to help free up some of the time of the individuals who are needing to be more dedicated to the case management and the services, service planning for the individuals versus transportation.
Thanks.
You're welcome. So for these strategies, the total is $105,013.77. Regarding the post-overdose response team budget, so this money for the post-overdose response team, you all signed our spending resolution back on March 18th. But when I was before you, I promised that I would come back with a detailed budget because we were in the early stages of planning this team. And so I have worked with Chief Balog and his team over at Burlington Police Department to really hammer out the details of what this would look like for us to have a embedded team to be able to respond to overdoses within the community. So these would not be law enforcement. These would not be sworn individuals. These are going to be peer support specialists. Who will be able to respond to overdose calls once the medical emergency has been cleared to facilitate treatment connections. They will have access to the radio to be able to respond not just to Burlington but to all jurisdictions. They will have the same communication to receive the same input that law enforcement received. They will also have clinical supervision and this will also be for transportation. But this is just informative because the resolution's already been signed, just to make that clear.
Example, Krista Knight, she's not going to be the only person, is she? Are we increasing that type of position? Because, I mean, she needs to be five people.
Yeah, so this would be to hire, what is budgeted is to be able to hire two, potentially three full-time positions. There is a wiggle room with the personnel and salary. And fringe so that we could bring on a third person if necessary to start with and then possibly a third. And so this would be a position that's similar to what Kristen and I does, a peer support specialist.
That is a vital position. Okay, thank you.
So just to give you an overview, currently in opioid settlement funds and interest received, we have $3,723,398.60 in our account. That first resolution that you signed, which included the post-overdose response team, is $1,278,060. The resolution that's before you this evening is for $1,302,862.27. That is going to leave us with a balance of funds in our settlement account. Of $1.1 million. And over this fiscal year, we are anticipated to receive another $1.1 million in deposits.
Question to you also. I spoke with Sheriff Page in Rockingham, and they are doing a fentanyl prevention educational program in their high schools because fentanyl would love to take out our young people, accidentally or whatever. And they've got an educational program going on up there. And I was just curious, is that something that this group of monies could possibly pay to form a team to go into our high schools? Because vaping, the whole nine yards, I'm just waiting for fentanyl or anything else that's gonna go in that vaping, because teenagers, they're fearless. You know, you can't touch them. And I'm just curious if we're thinking down the road, because we're seeing, you know, kids order stuff online thinking it's one thing and it's not. I mean, we've got a real devil after our young people. And whatever it takes, we got to do it. And this is one time we've got a shot with financing this to really jump on this and get the real hardcore grunt people to go after this in our schools. Shock and awe. I mean, it's got to be so serious, because maybe we all need to go to Kensington and Philadelphia and just walk the streets and see everybody's skin rotting off their body with, you know, all the other stuff that's going on. So that Alamance County is not removed from that. We just hadn't got on TV for it yet. So I was just curious, Tony, is that something that's even in the, I know you're looking at me, and I'm just curious, is that on the horizon?
You want to answer on the MOA piece and the education? No. Pick up the baby piece.
Okay. So actually I'm working with, I believe her name is Draven Ward in Rockingham County, to try to plan time for us to get together to discuss how we're spending our settlement dollars in comparison to how they're spending their dollars, and how we could potentially collaborate, right, or, you know, just bounce off resources and ideas. So regarding the MOA, I would have to see what strategy they did, they did their funding under, if it was an Exhibit A strategy or Exhibit B. But I think that, you know, it would be something we would have to explore. And it would also be something that we would need to have the school board on board with, and the school system.
Well, they just picked up another type of, it's not DARE, but it's something like it. I forget what it's called, but you cannot have enough prevention in your schools because it is getting younger and younger. I forget how many vaping pens they told me they found off of elementary, because little brother's going to do what big brother's doing, and big brother's going to be trained by parents. So can't stress this enough. I want my county to be known for saving its kids' lives.
And on the vaping piece, so we just brought out a new health educator. You know, we lost the one who was certified in that yeah. curriculum. She's getting trained in that curriculum. It's definitely reasonable to talk about substance use and vaping and how these pens can be changed to have other substances put on, so on and so forth, and put that awareness out there.
Well, I know when I went out to Woodlawn, I sat down in their sixth grade class. They're so precious because they're still walking in a straight line. They're scared to death. And they're all going, I would never do that because my friends would be so mad at me, because they truly believe that until this starts going after them. And that's where they got to build that strength to be able to say no and be okay with it. It really is cool to be smart and to be able to stand up and be bold against stuff like this. So, I where I stand. I just want us all safe from this stuff, because it's out to kill us.
So that brings us to our next steps, which is kind of included in this discussion as well. So the resolution that's before you tonight, if the board approves, of course, we would appreciate having that signed so that we could begin to execute those contracts and start with funding the organizations that have been identified. Also, I would like the board's approval to open the recovery housing support application back up to see who we may have interest come from. And then, you know, we will continue to identify needs and explore the requests that are available that are coming in from the community. We've recently been into some discussions with the Sheriff's Citizen Advisory Board regarding a program that they have that is for youth who are at risk and are identified by school resource officers. It's a full curriculum to really address different things that they experience at school as well as at home, helping to identify coping skills and just learning different ways to handle the stress that they're being put under. It does include some education around the different types of substances and the impacts that it has on their bodies, and sort of serves as a way for the resource officers to kind of mentor these individuals. I hope that's a good description. So there's been a lot of organizations that are reaching out, and this process is really continuous. You know, just as the funding is continuing to come down, we're continuously looking at what does this community need? What are the resources that we need to have available? How do we not only address the most immediate need, which is keeping our citizens alive, but how do we help them to get connected with treatment and then to have a healthy recovery out in the community? Housing is a critical part of that. Employment is a critical piece of that. Educational opportunities, transportation, you know, there's so much more that goes into it. And so really, we want to explore all of those possibilities and what that could look like for Alamance. I will come back before you, of course, with an update. If you approve for the recovery housing support, I would come back with the same information as this evening related to that strategy and funding. The other item is, we are working to put together an annual report. This annual report will showcase basically all of these opioid settlement strategies that we have funded throughout the year. It will provide you with the data and the impact reports that we're getting from the organizations we're working with. And it will help to sort of paint a story of our opioid settlement activity each year until we spend all of our settlement dollars. So I will be back before you in February to provide you with that report, as well as to give you some recommendations for our funding, recommendations for the next fiscal year.
You mentioned RTSA. Are they going to like have some like reserve specifically for this? Because, I mean, I've had to call about detox before, and they don't have a bed. Sometimes they have a bed. It's like you just never know. They could double in size and still be full. And I'm just curious, well, are they going to like have a special reserved a number of beds for this program that's guaranteed they're going to be able to get in a detox?
So I can't say that they're going to have reserved beds, but there's what this is going to do is this is going to allow individuals. So currently, if someone goes in and they are addicted to opioids, they're able to go on Suboxone to help with their withdrawal. When that time period is over for detox, if they wish to go to residential, they currently have to transition off the Suboxone to go to the residential program. This is going to allow them to actually be able to continue that medication. So not only are they going to get to go through the residential program, they're going to have the supported factors of their Suboxone, but they're also going to be able to participate in that program, which is going to aid in their having their long-term recovery. This is also going to help with the second piece, which is the recovery support services, is there's going to be someone there to help them transition back into the community. So many times individuals are able to access treatment and they do really well in that treatment program. But then when we bring them back into the community, many times the environments that wounded them, it's very difficult to maintain that recovery. So this will be connecting them with other services and supports that will support them long-term throughout their recovery journey. As well as helping them to with reunification with their family, employment, things to help them be successful citizens when they leave treatment.
That's like everybody thinks you go to jail and stay a couple months, you're clean. No, you're just holding your breath. It's waiting on you in the parking lot. And that's where you die if you use like you did before you went in. There's so much to this that it's just not easy. It's just not.
If any of you have questions, I'm happy to answer your questions.
Okay, thanks, Ashley. I was a bit surprised to see this request, and maybe I shouldn't have been, but I just want to make sure I understand like the broader picture. So, first of all, who is paying this money to us?
From the opioid settlement?
Yeah.
So the money is coming through... Susan may be able to answer this a little bit better, but it's basically from the lawsuits... with the drug makers and the different companies responsible, Walmart, Walgreens. We receive certain payments each like quarter sometimes. It's not really definitive when we will receive it. And then the money funnels into our account.
But there is a plan on how much we receive.
There is.
And it's over a period of like 18 years.
And that's another question. So how long do the funds taper off or are they consistent for 18 years?
7th, I think it's 7th.
They taper off.
They start to taper.
So in March, we approved a plan. And what I understood was that we would get contracts for those services for the March plan. Mm-hmm. Have we done that?
So for March, the services that were contracted with in the March's recommendation was the lease for the Alamance Behavioral Health Center. That was our contracted services through them in that facility to provide recovery support services. The other positions that were funded were the naloxone distribution, which is not a position. It was just to be able to provide the supply. So the health department, we have an order yet, but we are already using the supply we have to educate and train the community on how to administer Narcan. The positions that were funded is the peer support specialist and the recovery court coordinator. So recovery court coordinator, that position should be listed for us to begin applications. The peer support specialist, she's currently in the detention center, and we are working through the process to transition her. Trying to get through my mind.
I don't need the whole list. Okay. I'm just trying to think where all these are. Mm-hmm. So we had a plan. Was that like the first phase of the plan, and this is the second phase?
Mm-hmm.
Is there another phase? I mean, is this, we got more money coming in this year, but...
So we.
I'm just trying to get a sense of where we're going. Why did we have it all at once, and what are we doing now that's different than what we did?
So we received the money. We've been receiving the money now for about 3 years. Initially, there was a lot of hesitation. I will admit that a lot of it was on my part, waiting to see what the guidance was that we were going to receive from the opioid settlement team and from the North Carolina DOJ to tell us exactly the details of spending this money, what our requirements and our parameters were. So we, you know, had money that was in the bank. So we made our first round of recommendations based off of programs that we had data to support, that we could show evidence that there was effectiveness in these programs in helping those with opioid use disorder to address the most immediate risk, which is fatality. And to then to connect those that are overdosing with services. This round of funding, I did not feel comfortable recommending that we fund third-party organizations. I'm an Alamance County born and raised girl. I've lived here my whole life. There are very few organizations that I haven't met or interacted with, and I didn't feel that I could make that recommendation without some type of bias. So that is why we went through the request for application process. So that we are consistent and fair with all of our third-party organizations.
So are the amounts in this request based on the third party's request, or is it based on the county saying this is what we can do?
So we offered in this request about $1.5 million. I could tell you the breakdown of the dollars for each one, but it was in my presentation on the 18th, we set kind of parameters around what we could fund around each strategy. This is not going to be continuous money. So this is money for 2 years to help these organizations to either expand or implement new programs and services with the hope of sustainability moving past the settlement dollars.
And that's key. Is there a deadline for spending these monies?
I don't believe there's a deadline on any of these, though.
There's not a deadline.
There's not a deadline.
We just have to spend until every penny, including interest, is completely spent from the account.
But we need to be careful. We don't want to be in a position where, like ABSS with ESSER funds, we have this huge program, mm-hmm. then the funds taper off, and it's like either you have to fund it or you stop. And if there's no expiration of the funds, then a long-term, you know, conservative plan is the way to go. That where the services are sustainable.
Yes.
Over a long period of time. So I think as long as we've got those ideas in mind, we do have those ideas in mind?
Yes.
Okay. then I'm more comfortable with it. Thank you.
Mr. Horner.
I think I'm good.
Mr. Ashley.
I'll call. Thank you.
And as I understand it, these proceeds will continue for years. I was thinking the note was like 18 or something. And they do diminish over time. Because there are additional pieces of legislation out there, or not legislation, litigation out there, Kroger, for example. So there may or may not be future monies,
mm-hmm.
that we're not aware of yet.
Yes. They're still in ongoing litigation.
And you have, I think in our packet, on page 158, a resolution that you would like for us to pass.
That's correct.
And board members, do we have a motion to approve that resolution?
I'll make it.
Second.
Any further discussion?
Just to add something, while everybody's suing all these companies, don't forget that prescription pad is where all this mess started. So let's not let everybody off that light, because Walgreens filled a prescription. Somebody wrote that prescription that was abusing folks when it comes to stuff like that. It's just a lot of people that's on that trail with this. So, sorry.
Okay, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Unanimous. Okay, we have two requests for a short break. I'm not leaving, so if you and the gentleman in the back row would come forward, we're going to take a 7.5 minute break. We're back in session. Okay, item 9C. Jamie, you're back on, Sheila?
She's making her way to the podium. But Rick, are you going to present your message?
Yeah, I'm happy to introduce this. So I spoke with Ms. Merkel about this issue a couple of weeks ago related to a request that I think might have come from Alcovets originally. The desire was to look at allowing the service and consumption of alcohol in the parks at special events where a permit was obtained in advance and then all the participants who would be serving and selling alcohol were in compliance with ABC law. Again, that seems to be kind of a regional trend. Beer festivals, big events, they like to have some sort of a portion of the event that might be set aside for the service and consumption of alcohol. And we looked at the present ordinance that we had related to Parks and Rec, and it was not clear to me that there was any authority for that to even be entertained by the Parks and Rec Commission. So based on the fact that we kind of had some ambiguity as we currently stand, my suggestion was that we put forward an ordinance to explicitly allow that authority based on rules that they would create, fees they would impose, and then use that as the basis to move forward. So nothing about this would require that this happen. And frankly, I think we're pretty neutral on the topic in general, but this was the request. And so if you choose to adopt this ordinance, this would allow for that to happen.
And I'm available for any questions, but as Attorney Stevens has stated, the original request, this past year we held two large special events at Cedar Rock Park. The first is the annual Alcovets Balloon Festival, and the other one was the USDGC Women's Disc Golf Championship that both inquired about setting up an area for Alcovets. It's a beer garden area as part of their event. And then for the disc golf championship, they were interested in having a VIP ticketed area, which would include catering and beer and wine. Now, at the time, we turned down both requests last year because it is in our ordinance right now that we do not allow alcohol in county parks at the moment. So what we were asking was to change the ordinance as it applies to special events so that when we are considering the special events that rent out our facilities and close them down to the public, that there could be a way for them to get permitted a one-time special event permit through ABC to serve alcohol at those events if it is if this board agrees that that would be a good use of the space. So if the ordinance were to be changed, we would go back to our Parks Board Commission and revise our special event policy with very stringent guidelines within it of what would qualify, how it would be approved, and what the host of that event, so whoever the promoter or the event organizer is for that event that takes place in our park, what they would have to follow in order to have alcohol at that event.
More questions? Ms. Thompson?
Oh, I'll start. I'm a big no. There's a bar on every corner. Let's see, Burlington, Gibsonville, I think Mebane, Elon, they all have these social, whatever that's called. If you want to do that, do that. This is a park. It's a county. I don't think it was turning into a venue. Just got to be careful with that. There are places you can rent to have all that. I don't think this is a good look for veterans. Just going to put it out there. Just my opinion. For anybody, because this is the Bloom Festival is all about family, having a good time, vendors, food, and all kind of things. You'll have law enforcement there for security. It's just personal work with addiction and alcoholism. And that doesn't mean anybody has it that'll drink a beer every now and then. That's your own personal opinion. But I do not in any way want alcohol at Cedar Rock Park for any reason.
And just to be clear, we would not, staff is not making a recommendation or in favor of having it on a regular daily basis when the park is open to the public, or it would just be for the special events when the park is shut down to the public. But, and I also did learn as of today, Alcovets is no longer interested in serving alcohol at the Bloom Festival. So that was hot off the presses today.
I don't want just for a special reason. Just started an opioid crisis. I'm a hardcore no. That don't make it right or wrong. That is just my personal belief. And I ain't changing my mind. So y'all go ahead.
Mr. Lashley, do you have questions?
I just think it's important that everyone hears that the people who are having the private function, whether it's a corporate function, it's a birthday party, that they have the opportunity to say no, that I don't want alcohol at my function. Alcovest has decided they don't want alcohol up there, and that's fine. But I do believe that people should have an option if they so choose. I mean, do I really want people to be walking through facilities and parks and recreation with a 40 on their hip? No. But if you're having a wedding, you're having a corporate function, you're having a meet and greet, that's an opportunity that they could use, and the Parks and Recs can use to increase their revenue.
Are you saying it's okay to have a 40 on your hip if you're having a wedding?
Absolutely. I mean, hell, if you're going to be getting married, you probably should be drunk. I'm just saying, I'm a coin toss here, but I can understand. I'm just glad that you made it, said it out loud, that the people who come and fill out the paperwork to do the facilities, they have the opportunity to say yes or no to alcohol. If we had the ordinance and they said yes, they could have it. But at the end of the day, it's really not going to hurt my feelings either way. But I just think, I'm an options guy. I like as many options as I possibly can.
Mr.
Carter. I don't have any questions, thank you.
Mr. Carter.
Well, I agree with Pam. My first reaction is no. I think we're making an assumption that the revenue is going to contribute to the benefit of the taxpayers. I have had in my conversations about this issue a number of questions raised about whether the revenues that it generated would actually exceed the cost associated. I mean, we would need the Sheriff's Department providing security during times like that. There are so many other issues. Cleanup after an event. Would we be, I think we
Yeah, the, right now our special event policy, all of those costs are on the host of the event. The cleanup, security, Sheriff's Department, all of those costs that, depending on the size of their event and the criteria that is set in our special event policy, none of that cost falls back on the county. It's on the host of the event.
So would there be a fee in addition to the cost then?
We could consider one. We haven't finalized what the special event policy change would be yet.
But then we go to a whole different issue. And I'm afraid this is one that has touched us in North Carolina. We have a tendency right now, it seems, for what we call conservative boards, conservative bodies, to approve things they've always opposed because it generates revenue. And I think we have to draw the line someplace. Just because it generates revenue is not the best reason to do something. And put our children and families in a position where they are in the park and are dealing with this issue, and I don't think it's the right thing for us to do.
Guess I'm last in line. Thank you this morning. She shared her time with me and gave me a lot of explanation, details, and I did ask about the additional revenue. At this point, there is none. As I understand, of course, the Recreation Board could change that.
Yeah, we could. They could change that.
So, and I don't know whether we would have to approve it or not.
I don't think so. I think I drafted this in such a way that they could implement rules that they feel to be adequate to meet their needs in terms of fee structures, needed security, needed cleanup. And to the points that have been made so far, I don't know that there'd necessarily be any additional revenue from the fees assessed. The additional revenue could come in the form of the types of events that would be hosted that otherwise would not be hosted at that place. So if there were events, I'm going to steal one from the director and say that if there were a barbecue event that wanted to have a barbecue festival and they wanted to have beer associated with that, well, they would look for a venue other than an Alamance County Park because this would not be an option for them there. So that's kind of how it may affect overall revenue.
And like Jamie said, the committee could decide to make it, if you want an alcohol event at Cedar Rock Park, it's going to cost you $1,000. There is a way to generate revenue.
Right.
It's just a matter of how high do you want to make the cost.
Right.
Just a suggestion. Like I said, I don't have a dog in this fight.
Really. Well, I've talked to Alco Vets, two of the individuals and their leadership, and they both said no. One's a city councilman, and I was asking, how would you vote if you were a county commissioner? He said, I'd vote no.
That's what he told me this morning.
And additionally, I've talked to the sheriff, I've talked to the second in command, and so forth, and they did not encourage, in fact, oppose doing this. I have a wife with 50 plus years, four children, seven grandchildren. ignore Mr. Carter's comments. and three great grandchildren, ages, you know, very, very young to much, much older. And I like the fact they can go out. There is no alcohol that, you know, is at least legal. And I've never seen alcohol out there at Cedar Rock, or I've kayaked, I've gone on canoeing trips, all kinds of things with county facilities. It's just nice to have a place you can relax. You're not worried about someone driving and drinking too much. The veterans thought it was a bad idea for their it was a question they asked, but they were not promoting it. Law enforcement has encouraged me to say no, and I'm going to say no. So at this point, we may want to take a vote.
Hold on.
Hold on,
just
after Steve.
I just wanted to say, to be clear, we are not asking to have alcohol in the parks when it's open to the public.
Right.
It is just for when the parks are rented out for a private event that it's closed to the public, and you have to either pay a ticket or an entry or
My comment, I think, to you on the phone this morning was, how do you explain to someone in the park they would like to pop a top on a beer or whatever, and they see it being consumed over at the wedding reception or somewhere else, and now you're saying, no, not here, but it's okay there.
Right, and that's where it would go back to the commission of whether or not we would require somebody to rent out the whole park for a wedding reception if they're going to have alcohol.
I don't want to close the parks.
Right.
Just for a wedding reception either.
Our special event policy right now allows for one park closure rental a month for somebody can rent out. Right now it's limited to one per month.
Well, the last comment I'll make is the three departments we have that are running short on staff right now are the three departments that would typically be most impacted by the use of alcohol. EMS, Sheriff's Department, and DSS. I mean, we're trying to staff them up, and we've got an item coming up down the line, which we hope will have an impact on that. And I don't see trying to do something that's going to create more work for our people.
It's interesting because right now we see our General Assembly. They have approved sports betting,
mm-hmm.
and up in Cherokee, you can go up there and buy cannabis, go over to the casino, drink, and gamble. So you can do it all up there and get you some moccasins and wear them there. Where are you going? And in Danville, the casino, they just got a tent. They're building the thing, and I know it's just going to bring money. It's all about money. And at the bottom of their commercial, before they even got in, for gambling problem, call 1-800, blah, blah, blah. And then I see where DHHS is starting a new treatment program for gambling. Maybe if we don't flood it and just dangle this carrot in front of everybody that are so quick to getting caught in stuff like this, it's just the personality, how easy they are. But you know what? If we want Parks and Rec to have more money, we should fund them better. Bill and I say that every year because they are rock stars in this county and they are treated like that little stepchild. So we need to do better by them because they bring a lot here and we don't need to drink to get a couple of $100. I know what it does and I have no use for it. So, and I appreciate you guys bringing it up, but I'm a big no. I do believe Rockingham County's people in their community is suing their commissioners because of some things they were doing trying to get a casino there. So it's money. We see greed in everything we do. I ain't touching it.
I'm going to follow Mr. Turner's lead and call the question.
That's not a motion. That's no motion.
You can motion.
All right.
Is there a motion?
Well, thank you.
Thank you for your time. I appreciate it.
Obviously, with no motion, no vote, it does not pass. Okay. Mr. Bittman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think Attorney Stevens is going to kick us off on this agenda item.
Yeah, I'll be happy to take a lead on this one, at least to get us started. So, Mr. Ripperman, I spoke a few months ago related to a need to update our ambulance ordinance. It had been a while since we had really visited this item, and we felt like it was in need of revision, and so we made some revisions to bring us into comport with current practice and best practices, but also the idea of potentially allowing for franchises to do some of the transports that happen on a daily basis throughout the county. So we have convalescent that basically is transporting people who don't necessarily need medical services en route between one facility and the next, and then non-emergency transportation that could be performed by a franchise ambulance service. And so the idea in drafting this ordinance was basically to have a turnkey set of terms that we would expect from somebody who would come and franchise with us. And that way, if we decided to franchise out any of the services we currently do with our EMS, which, as you pointed out, Mr. Carter is short-staffed, we'd have a set of rules for them to go by. We could put out the advertisement to solicit bids for franchisees, and they would know what we needed from them in advance. So we've drafted this ordinance. There is a criminal penalty associated with violating it, so it would require two readings and votes from the board, but we're happy to answer questions tonight as you go through it.
Yeah, and just to piggyback on Attorney Stevens, so currently the way we operate is we have 8.5 paramedic level ambulances on the road, so 8 of those are 24 hours, one of those is 12 hours, that makes kind of peak out at 9 ambulances, and then we have 2 convalescent ambulances on the road, Monday through Friday, one works 9 to 6, the other works 10 to 7, and so they do, you know, doctor's appointments, discharges from the hospital. But what we find is almost daily, it winds up falling back on the paramedic level units. So we do about 300 convalescent transports a month. 200 of them are done by those two ambulances, and the other 100 fall back on the paramedic level units. So if we could look in the future at contracting that out, in effect, it gives you back about 100 hours worth of paramedic level coverage. So we don't send paramedic level ambulances to do these transports when we're out of ambulances. But things are very dynamic. And so you might be down to four ambulances, and you say, we're going to go do this discharge at the hospital. While they're up on the floor picking the patient up to return them to a nursing facility, then the mass wreck comes out or the system dumps, and then all of a sudden you're out of ambulances when you could have had that one. So we kind of find ourselves serving two masters in effect. You have to take care of the non-emergency convalescent transports. You have to take care of the 911. If you let the hospital back up because you're not getting patients out, throughput's affected. It's harder to get the patient seen that we're bringing into the emergency room. So it all has a major effect on the system. And just to kind of give you an idea, in 2020, we were transporting 17,465 patients. So this is across the board. This is emergency and non-emergency. In 2023, we did 19,174 with the same amount of resources on the road.
Ray, if you get a private company to do this specific thing, does that mean the two that you're using now for convalescent will become part of your fleet for 911?
Correct.
And you just got, that'll give you what, 9 or 10?
So that would bring us up to 9 24 hours.
To do the entire county?
Yes, ma'am.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And we've got a new one ordered.
10. Two. Woo.
Does Kelly have a recommendation?
Our recommendation would be to allow us to franchise this type of service. We could, if the board would like to authorize us to go through an RFP process, we can put out a request for proposals and see what type of companies might apply and do it in a formal way. Or you could just approve this tonight, and we could see if anybody comes expressing interest.
Except it takes two readings.
It takes two readings, yeah. Thank you. It does take two readings.
That's right. Motion to approve.
Just one more question. This population that does this transportation, is that mostly Medicare or Medicaid?
We see, so a lot of the patients are in the elderly, so it's
right.
A lot of Medicare. There's some Medicaid, and then, of course, there's always some self-pay. We try to limit this to stretcher-bound patients, but inevitably we wind up transporting non-stretcher-bound patients as well.
So the amount that we usually see that we have to write off, it's always over $1 million. This probably doesn't come from that population, does it? Maybe.
Maybe a little bit, but no.
Not
I mean,
like
for the most, we wouldn't have as much self-pay as we would for the emergency side of it.
Okay. I think we need to look into this. This helps the 911 part of EMS, and they need all the help they can get.
To Ms. York's point,
with kids laying on the ground. So.
To Ms. York's point, there's nothing about adopting this that would bind us to actually look at franchising out, but this is the underpinning that would be required before we did that. So the board should decide later on what the desire is in terms of franchising out the service, but until we have this ordinance in place, we wouldn't be able to do it.
And I believe that contracts would come back to the board for approval, so you'd still have
correct.
Another chance.
Yes. That's correct.
To review them and ensure that they are meeting the requirements of this ordinance.
So we'll actually have three shots. Tonight's first reading, next meeting, second reading, and then the approval of a contract, if approved.
At some point in the future, yes. We don't have any interested parties that I'm aware of at this point, so it would probably be some point in the future once we gauge the level of interest.
That would be negotiated with all you folks.
That's correct. They would have to meet at the bare minimum the elements of the franchise, which Mr. Ripper and I have been through together to make sure it meets what our base requirements would be. So any contractual terms would be on top of compliance with the franchise.
I do note in your proposed ordinance requires a Viper radio system and so forth. That is so important. And I know that Burlington, for example, still is not on the Viper system. We're still having communication issues because Burlington won't go along with the rest of the county, basically. I think Gibsonville's on Viper, maybe one more. The shooting with President Trump Saturday, part of that issue, what's coming out, was lack of a radio connectivity and cooperation with law enforcement. If you don't have the same radio systems, guess what? You aren't communicating. And that is so not only important, but it was really pointed out heavily, will be, with the investigation, that they had different radio systems they were using and could not communicate. So I think the Viper requiring that is essential in this contract.
And Ray, the two that you're talking about that do the current transportation, those that man those vehicles are well-trained paramedics. They're 911 material, right?
So they're EMTs.
Okay.
Actually, one is retiring at the end of the month. One just put in their resignation.
We're
so
not
going to
let them do
two.
That. We're not going to let them do that.
So we'll be, so, but they'll make an easy transition.
But they're good.
Yes.
Okay.
It was Carter made a motion, I'll second. Any further discussion on the first reading of the ordinance?
Just a quick question. Why are there criminal penalties in the ordinance?
So it's a criminal penalty to seek services with the intent not to pay for those services. And that creates the opportunity for there to be a penalty for someone who tries to abuse the system in a way that we wouldn't want. So if you were to seek ambulance services without the desire, well, without any intent to pay for it. And then also if one of the franchisees were to somehow violate some provision of the ordinance, there are some in here related to fraudulent applications, that would allow them to be penalized criminally as well.
And maybe I read that incorrectly, but it also would mean if the ambulance arrives out there, they can't demand payment before they give you assistance.
That's an additional element that's required of each franchisee to agree that they're not going to charge in that way. So that's a contract provision that they have to abide by, but the criminal penalty actually applies to a fraudulent attempt to obtain services by the customer or some breach of a portion of the ordinance that relates to assertions made about having licensure and then not having licensure. That could be a criminal penalty on the franchisee.
But now I believe they can demand payment if it's for transport. Is that correct? I can't ask for payment up front if it's for transport.
I'm honestly not sure. I'll have to look and see if that's how they normally do business. I don't know if you might be able to answer that question.
So I think in this ordinance it did allow if it's a scheduled transport,
right,
they can inquire about payment. But if we were out of ambulances and we requested them to run a 911 call,
right,
they would have to transport that patient to the hospital. They wouldn't be able to talk about payment while they were on the scene.
Right.
So any kind of emergency care, they would have to render transport. And then they could bill on the back end just like we do as well.
Okay.
We got a vote, right?
Yeah. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? First reading, we'll see you next meeting.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
But does this require two readings?
By the way, next meeting will be 2 weeks. Because July has more than. It's the first Monday.
3 weeks from today.
Yeah. My birthday.
All right.
Get to work on my birthday.
Thanks, sir.
Good evening.
Just wanted to see if he confirms his birthday today.
So thank you for the opportunity to speak with you this evening. I am here regarding a proposed renewal of our existing agreement with Vincent Valuations LLC, which expires in August 16th. So we have just over a month. Vincent provided revaluation services for our 2023 reappraisal, and we still have a few pending appeals before the state board. We also need to get started on our 2027 reevaluation. Our office has worked closely with Vincent for the past few years, and I can attest to their knowledge, their hard work, and professionalism. I believe you may have also heard from some of our Board of Equalization members, as we've gotten a number of positive remarks from them regarding Vincent. We're very happy with the service that we've received and would like to expand their services to fully outsource our 2027 reevaluation. I believe this is the best option for our citizens to ensure the highest level of quality that we can provide. Now, as a service agreement, there is no requirement that this be bid, although we certainly could do so if the board wishes. We did bid this out in 2021, and Vincent was the bid winner. Funds for the agreement have already been secured in our budget, and we're being offered a 20% discount to continue with them due to their familiarity with the county. My recommendation is that we renew with Vincent for the 2027 revaluation. Now, this is an information item, so there is no action by the board needed at this time. I'm merely seeking to inform the board, and with your blessing, I'll work with county staff to prepare an agreement for the board's approval at a later meeting. Do you have any questions for me?
Well, I think this will hopefully deal with the questions we've had raised about the commercial valuations.
Exactly.
And I'm hoping this will solve that problem. Do we not have to have a bidding process?
Not for service.
No, there's not a requirement to bid out pure services like the one we're anticipating here.
Okay.
Yeah.
I have some questions.
Sure.
How much did they charge us to do the 2023 one?
Oh, goodness. I'd have to pull the numbers on that.
We've got it.
Can you help with that, hon?
Yeah, I think the number that you had shared with me, Jeremy, was $1,334,719.
That's the total cost of the revaluation.
Oh, right.
A hybrid that included internal and external costs. The Vincent contract is somewhere in the 500s, I believe, but I'd have to pull that number. I didn't understand
that to be the case.
Can you just repeat that number again? That's a total cost of the reval?
It's a total cost, which included in-house and Vincent valuation,
sure.
So I can't separate just the Vincent
right.
part from that number, but that number is $1,334,719.
Thank you.
What are you looking at?
It's a hybrid system.
That's correct.
Explain what a hybrid system is.
So in a hybrid, there's a mixture of in-house and outsourced. We did a hybrid in 2009, and the 2023 was also a hybrid, so we had county staff working on it alongside contracted staff. By comparison, in 2017 it was fully in-house, and in 2001 it was fully outsourced.
Okay. How much are they looking at it being this time when we do it again?
So we don't have an exact figure. We do have kind of a ballpark number, about $2.6 million.
Okay. Did they do, whenever, and then this, I just need to ask these questions.
Sure.
We had a list, okay. What Mr. Commissioner Carter was talking about, concerns and questions about commercial property, because this is just so you know you have to explain things to me. There's a list of properties, and I'm just wondering, was there any reason, did Vincent do commercial appraisals?
They did, alongside our staff.
They did?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Did we have any kind of... I mean, I would be curious, like, was GKN, is that considered a commercial? I'm thinking big. Is that how we do this?
In a broad sense, yes. We can differentiate commercial and industrial and business, but broadly, it's all commercial.
Like Caterpillar?
Sure.
Like Lidl? Like UPS? I mean, you get down Interstate 40, and it looks like we own the world with all these big buildings. And we had heard just... things say that a lot of these stores, like the Lowe's was a biggie, got pretty big refunds or discounts or whatever the word needs to be. Most residential, we didn't. It seems like it kind of fell on that back. And I'm saying this because I really just don't know. But I'm just curious, is this group, the same group, going to do commercial next time? Because, see, it was my understanding that they didn't. It was kind of like an estimate or something like that.
So that's why we hired them initially, was we needed commercial support and schedule of value support. And as we went, we expanded it a little bit so they could bring in the residential side as well. So they definitely did commercial this time. We would have them do all the commercial next time. Now, the...
And when you say all the commercial...
All.
Who did the what that they didn't?
We did. It's a mixture of our staff and their staff. We have a commercial appraiser, they have a commercial appraiser.
So we do have commercial appraisers?
Yes. We have one.
one for the county.
Right.
That's kind of like we're hitting it with ambulances. Okay. Yeah, I just have a lot of questions about this whole thing, and I don't get really what I need to ask you. I could get half a bill's sense of this. I'd be way ahead. How much they went back because there were some questions about commercial, right? Can I say that?
You just did.
I mean, I'm.
I'm not sure how to answer that.
Can I write you a note?
Yeah.
There were questions about certain things because you said there were 5 out of 10. Remember, you asked me, said up 10, we did 10. There were 5 that were correct. Okay, without saying anything. Can you recall how much that we had to pay for that specific group of 10 that we asked about? Because we kept hearing so many things, and as commissioners, we need to make sure that what we're hearing is correct or it's not correct.
Right. So the appraisals themselves were a little over $40,000 for the 10.
For 10.
Mm-hmm. And that was for the initial work. We had an option to finish that out. That was not both sides. It would have been 80 with both sides. But
when you say both sides, what do you mean?
So there's an initial review that they do,
gotcha.
And they communicate the values orally, but if you're going to actually proceed with those, then to get the written report doubles the price. And that's not this, for clarity to anyone listening, that's not this company. That is a completely separate company that we're talking about. That we're talking about Newmark in this case rather than Vincent.
Okay.
Gold Star.
And if we have, and if we've heard about various folks getting commercial, you know, some discounts or refund, whatever that word is. I just wish I knew really what I was trying to ask.
I think what you're saying is there was a question about whether or not the valuations were accurate on those properties. To my understanding, there were no discounts.
That ain't even the word, right. So don't pay attention to what
right.
I'm trying to say.
Just a matter of whether or not the value was accurate or not.
Yeah, because it.
If I might volunteer. If I might volunteer. So, to my awareness, there's only 3 individual cases that are all part of the same systematic problem that we have found to not be correct. And that's when we're dealing with some of the big box. There's 3 in particular. We had an outside company review 10. And
did we pick those 10? Or did they pick those 10? Just like out of a hat, so to speak.
The 10 were all that were in that category that were affected. That was the whole universe of big box stores that we had concern about. And of the whole universe of big box stores, they complimented us on our quality of work. They were impressed and said we were above average as a county tax department. Our commercial appraiser was extremely pleased to hear that because all he's heard is negative comments to his work.
Who complimented us?
This is the 2 MAI appraisers from Newmark Valuation Services. And again, that really encouraged our commercial appraiser to hear from such high status experts that it was unusually good for a county. Now, 5 of them, they completely agreed with our assessment. They said, you nailed it, that's the number. And that's what was bizarre. They're not used to having that. 3 of them, there was a very small variance, not a big deal. Or 2 of them was a small variance. On 3 of them, it was significant. And those are the 3 cases that I'm aware of, which is all just kind of one problem repeated for 3 times. Other than that, I'm not aware. I hear that there's talk about commercial being undervalued, but I've not been presented with any evidence. I just heard talk.
I understand, Jeremy. With taxes, it's a tough word. I'm just curious, like the ones that weren't correct, are we going to fix that?
So with the ones in question that are problematic, I would also add one kind of caveat in understanding this. I don't know that we would have ended up in any different place than we ended up with because we live in a world of appeals boards. The concern I have is that we should have gone through the process, and if we ended up there, we ended up there. We circumvented that and went straight to the end.
So I don't know that we would get to any different place. If we try to fix that, so to speak, at this point, I think we go back through the appeals boards, and I think that we may not make progress. And if we did, the cost would probably outweigh the benefits.
But you
we're talking about at, I'm sorry for interrupting.
No, I'm
at,
sorry.
At revaluation would be the time to address that.
Okay, that's what I'm talking about. That's when we can do something different.
Yes.
Okay. And we're going to
remind everybody, and just to keep you aware, we're on a 4-year schedule now,
yeah.
Not an 8.
Yeah. Well, I'm asking questions that I'm probably not asking correctly.
And for clarity, the parcels in question that were problematic were not part of the Vincent side of the valuation. Their commercial appraiser worked on other properties. Our commercial appraiser worked on these in particular. And so this would not have bearing on Vincent.
But in the proposal, all the appraisals would be done by Vincent.
Yes.
So none of our people will be part of that, or they'll be part of that?
They will not be part. Vincent would do the work.
Got a couple questions. So, we paid Vincent to do specific work in the last reval, and that was $500,000?
I think the total I'm seeing is $662,500.
That may be. 662?
Yes. That was a contract that was from 2021 to 2024.
Is that the contract amount or the paid amount? Because we did not consume the contract amount.
I mean, it's,
so we contracted for up to $662,500. I pulled that contract, and that was totally.
Okay, we didn't spend quite that much, so maybe around.
Yeah, I think we're in the
581.
Thank you. But the request to do proposal for Vincent to do all of it will cost $2.3 million.
Ballpark 2.6.
Why would we do that? Why would we do that?
It has to be done. We can spend that much to do it ourselves. We can spend that much to pay someone else to do it.
We already have people on staff that do it.
Not at this level, not the scale of the project we're talking about. So, for
what's that project compared to this project we just did?
Yeah, sure. Because we hybridized.
What's that mean?
We use some of our staff. We use some of their staff. We've actually reduced staff since then. We've had some retirements, and we've shuffled around, so we've not filled retirements. So we currently do not have revaluation staff. If we're going to in-house it, because that's one of the questions I had, is, well, what if we did it in-house? We would have to hire on, basically, to double our current appraisal staff. The folks that we have that can maintain us from year to year have their hands full. We would have to double that staff to have a secondary team that can work on this. And by the time you look at the cost of facilities, the cost of cars and equipment, et cetera, and some of these folks would have to be very skilled in order to pick this up and run an evaluation.
But don't you want our people very skilled? Huh? Aren't our people supposed to be very skilled?
Sure. Yeah.
You just said they would have to be very skilled.
Right. I'm indicating the labor is not cheap.
Nope.
It's not cheap right now, and it won't be cheap for additional.
Well, you're talking about over $2 million. That ain't cheap either.
That's right. I don't think I can improve on the price doing it in-house.
Well, I know, that's
and
not
the point. And the problem is, at the same price point, then, you know, we're also dealing with where to put them and et cetera. I don't know that we can do a 2027 reval if we do it in-house. Because by the time we assemble the pieces, that I just don't think that's feasible, maybe 2029. So if we outsource, you've got folks, this is all they did. This is their business. And the schedule would not be a problem. We wouldn't have to find a place to put them, buy cars for them. We're going to contract.
What do our people do when they're not doing a reval? Because I know in your tax is kind of seasonal. I'm clueless here. Help me understand, because I know people walk in here to pay those taxes. I see their faces, and they got that paper. And I'm just curious, what's going on while that's not going on?
So inspections issues thousands of permits every year. And every time they issue a permit,
okay,
a copy goes to one of our appraisers. The appraiser goes out to the property, reviews the change, updates the information that we have, so that we can then take that into account in their next year's bill.
Okay.
Additionally, we have, if there's demolitions, fire, damage, appeals, citizen concerns where they want us to come out and look at properties, that supplements. But permitting is obviously the biggest driver.
New bills.
Yeah.
Well, on a new permit, wouldn't that be driven by the purchase price as much as by the price?
The purchase price is a data point, but the concern that we have is that we need to do two things. We need to meet a certain frame of time. We need to do two things. We need to meet a certain frame of time. So we want our values right now to look like they're from January 1st, 2023, not July of 2024. And that only gets worse as time goes on. And if you use that current sale, you're out of step with the market that we're required by law to go back to. The second thing is this. You know, if you have somebody that is a really good bargainer and someone who's a really poor bargainer. You have a seller that might be really in a bind or have no need to sell at all. So you can have the exact same house in the exact same neighborhood, just one lot over, and you can have sales that are not in agreement with each other. We can't put two different values not in agreement with each other because we're one appraising, one assessing entity. So we have to put something that agrees. So we would take the sale into consideration as a data point, but we have to go out and appraise it per the schedule of values put in place in the last revaluation to try to keep everybody consistent until the next revaluation. And I think we have an excellent staff doing that, but that's what they specialize in. That's what they do, and they are wall-to-wall every day. In order to take on a project like this, you would need a separate staff. And the skill set is different, too. You're looking at statistical analysis. You're looking at modeling. This is not their forte. A lot of our folks, they're old contractors and builders. They're awesome at a construction site. And then you try to put them in front of a computer system with a multi-monitor display and have them pull up spreadsheets. It's just a different skill set. If we were going to do it, we'd have to have just a secondary staff, or you can buy the expertise.
You're asking us to approve that set or just correct you?
At this point, I just want to get the information to the board to see if there's any concerns about us going forward with Vincent. I have no concerns. I've been very happy with the work they've done, our interactions with them. I think that we're in good hands if we work with them. Obviously, I will be keeping an eye on Vincent. But they're not the sort of company that I worry about keeping an eye on. In the last revaluation, their standards were, I hate to say, higher than ours. But this is their business. This is what they do.
Jeremy?
And so I think that
this is our business to be just as high standard as they are. These boys get paid big bucks.
Yeah.
And I mean, get paid for your job. Mm-hmm. And That scares me when you say they're better than we are. No, we have to be better all the time too.
Well, what I'm trying to indicate is that in the course of reevaluation, we don't do those day in, day out. Things that we would say, yep, that's checked, everything's good, and they would look at it and say, for an amateur, but here's what we think you need to do. And it was very eye-opening to see the way that someone that's their business from beginning to end versus somebody that does that every 8 years historically. It's one of the reasons I'm recommending that we do a full outsourcing. I think that they will bring a higher level of expertise than I can provide.
Sure.
Jerry, my concern is not Vincent or not Vincent. Sure, it's the scope of what we outsource versus the scope of what we don't outsource. And
right.
Because I don't truly understand that at this moment, I'm not inclined to give any insight at all.
Jeremy, mm-hmm. Can you just explain the difference between an industrial appraisal and a residential appraisal?
It's radically different. Now you're talking about
radically
someone
different.
Who is a trained residential appraiser, not a commercial appraiser. So.
And most of the people that we have on our staff are pretty much competent in the residential side of the business.
That's the bread and butter of the business. We have one person that works with commercial.
How much does it cost to do an appraisal for an industrial? Like GKN, I think, was brought up earlier. How much does something like that cost? If you had to do an appraisal on that, how much would something like that cost?
So we just contracted out with big boxes, and we were paying $4,000 a piece. And we didn't And we didn't get a report. It would have been $8,000 for a full appraisal.
Okay. So there lies the reason why
present banking business
the 1.3 goes to 2.6.
Sure.
Okay, if you're so concerned about our commercial or industrial, I would like to focus on, not so much
commercial.
Because
they're different, right? Those
Absolutely.
Two things are different. Okay.
Well, but they're different,
similar.
But they're similar.
They're big. That's
Just
what I know.
Big box stores.
Okay.
So, you know, with that being said, it's understandable why your costs have went up so much because, you know, even if you take pick any industrial complex you want, whether it's GKN or Lowe's or Home Depot, you put the value on it, and then you walk over and you multiply it by, I mean, you divide it by 100 and you multiply it by the tax rate. I'm going to say that chances are that the tax bill is going to be less than $30,000. And we haven't even got into the business property
mm-hmm.
side of it. And that's what I'm saying. The difference between GKN and Lowe's is monstrous. Lowe's has, look at all that inventory they have inside those four walls. GKN may have a process, you know, a manufacturing process that they get paid on the commodities. So it's understandable why you need someone with this kind of expertise to pay that kind of money because you probably will get a whole lot better value for the dollars that you're reevaluating. That's just my personal opinion.
Well,
you
know, and
also that industrial property will have furniture, fixtures, and equipment that depreciate, but they don't end in useful life.
Right.
So once it's depreciated, you're not collecting the taxes on it. While the retail entity will have inventory, which is usually constant or growing, and it's going to be at constant level of
yep.
tax generation. It's different, but it's the process for commercial evaluation is looking at the sales approach, the construction and replacement value on the brick and mortar, and then the income approach on it if you were to rent it. And you put those three together and try to come up with an average of what you think those three, or pick the best one of the three, and just the approach to it.
I will say it might be useful also to understand what's going on, is that we're asking for a full list and measure. That's the terminology within the industry. So different types of reappraisal. You have the drive-by reappraisal, which is they never get out of the car. Right. And you can order those and pay for those, and counties
mm-hmm.
do that. You have the walk-around reappraisal, which is what we did in 2009 when I was part of the appraisal staff. That's what we did, which is that you walk around properties, which is an upgrade from a drive-by. You've got a measuring tape with you, but you rarely deploy it. In the full list and measure, they're actually remeasuring structures mm-hmm. as they go. They're confirming the information we have. And of course, that causes them to move more slowly. That increases the cost of the project. But I think it's important. I looked at some numbers earlier today, and if you use the Labor Bureau's CPI calculator and take what we paid for historical revaluations and put them in today's dollars, our 2001 reval in today's dollars is $2.7 million. Our 2009 reval was $2.4 million. And so this is just very typical. And then you get to 17 and 23. 17 time adjusts to 1 million, and 23 to about 1.4. So why the 2.7, 2.4 dropping down to half price? Because I did those two appraisals, or oversaw the two appraisals, and I found ways to be budget friendly. I've done everything I can to pinch pennies and cut costs. The concern I have is you can get away with that once. We got away with it twice. I just don't recommend trying that a third time. I think that we need a full list and measure. I think we need to know that our data is good, know that our data is clean. If we continue to not do the full process, sooner or later that's going to catch up with us, and I don't want that to happen.
Will Vincent be alongside the folks at the Equalization Board after the reeval
yes.
happens?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's key.
Full service, one side or the other.
And I came in a couple of times and watched them work. Very professional.
I'd also point out there were complaints about Lowe's real estate valuation. What those complainers were not considering at all was the fact that they also paid income tax or paid county taxes on the inventory which was tremendous.
The business personal.
So, yeah, that all the numbers that were being complained about were not apples to apples. Big point. Mr. Lashley, you were pointing that out.
Yes, sir.
I think we ought to continue, at least give you a nod of approval for Vincent. Board, express your opinions.
I'll make a motion.
I'll second it.
And did we? So again, you did not need a motion.
I do not need it. I'm just wanting to make sure the board is fully informed and just. So I'm seeking your blessing. Is this an avenue that we're good to continue down?
Do we have goals to be able to build our tax department to where we can do this?
I do not.
You don't? Okay.
No. I don't know that it's the most efficient use of resources.
Do other counties do? Do they always hire somebody out?
It just depends
on the county?
There are counties that run two teams. They have their year-to-year new construction team. They have the revaluation team. There are those that totally outsource, and there's those that hybridize like we did last time.
Okay.
Have we looked? I think I had a conversation. Have we looked to see how we compare with peer counties?
In terms of in-house versus?
In-house versus
I don't think we have a list. I haven't seen that. Who's doing what?
I don't have that just immediately. I do have some information from DOR. I could pull that may have that listed.
Might want to look at, you know, having a qualified MAI appraiser, what would that cost? What would the actual cost?
And now, I'm not aware, and I can't speak definitively, I'm not aware of any county that has an MAI appraiser.
I've been told, now, I don't know this for a fact, but I've been told that Union County has one.
I just spoke with Union County today. They do not.
They do not, okay.
No.
What would you think, $250,000 to get an MIA in here?
Maybe.
Per year?
Maybe. I don't know.
Like so much more money working at the bank, you know, doing appraisers at
$4,000, $8,000
a pop.
At Certified General, and that's what Union County has.
They're bigger, something.
Only slightly. I mean, I wouldn't put them totally out of the
smaller population, but bigger.
Larger population.
Larger population.
Yeah, but not radically. It's not a Durham and Mecklenburg or something. It's not radically out of step with.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What is the county manager's recommendation? If we look at it and gather numbers.
I think what we're talking about is gauging your comfort level with fully outsourcing the revaluation. And then are we okay to not bid it, but for continuity's sake, to move forward with bids and valuations?
Does the 2.3, is that the 20%?
We don't have...
2.6.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. And until we engage with a proposal from them, we don't have a solid number. That's just a projected amount at this point.
Thank you.
I don't think any of us want to go through the questions on the commercial evaluations that we went through last year or so.
I'm not sold on that amount of money. And not just because this is y'all's thing, but I hear that amount of money and
Jeremy, can you tell us, I mean, the last time you sent me something of our tax base, mm-hmm. I saw a 21 point something billion dollar number. Mm-hmm. Take 2.6 million and divide it into that, and you'll see that you're getting a great deal to value your stuff. Now, I know it's a lot of money. I'm just scared to ask you, we have $2.6 million to pay.
Well, we actually would start setting aside money to be able to afford this. So in this year's budget, we've budgeted $1 million.
So do it again next year.
And do it again. And then by the time we're ready for revaluation, then you have the money.
Gotcha.
Thank you.
That's tough. Good stuff.
Thank you, Charlie.
I just want to be on record that I'm not comfortable saying let's do a full outsourcing.
I'm
100%
not
comfortable with that. I need a lot more information.
Jeremy.
Yes.
To answer his question, because I sort of feel the same way, because that's why I asked you that pointed question.
Mm-hmm.
We have people in-house that can do property evaluations. Like residential property.
Residential.
But
right.
What we don't have is we don't have someone just to do the industrial, the commercial. And that's what Vincent could do for us. So to answer Craig's question, why couldn't our folks focus on the residential and just get Vincent just to take care of the commercial and industrial?
Well, first of all, we don't have enough staff to do that. We have just enough to cover the permits that have been indoor. So we'd have to hire additional staff, and then we'd have to train additional staff. So to get a 2027 revaluation goes out the window at that point. But if we're comfortable pushing back to 29, then if we're only interested in the residential, you know, we need to get appraisers, we need to get data collectors, we need to get data entry, we need to get facilities, we need to get cars, we need to get computers, we need training time. It's a big project. I would only recommend that if the county just takes a hard and fast position that we want pure in-house, we want no outsourcing, let's just build a building and put a crew over there. Then it becomes feasible to do that. I don't want to dabble with it because then you've made all that investment, and what do? You let people go. So that would be a concern trying to hybridize out.
Well, that was kind of the point of my question, too. Look at it. What would it cost us to be able to do it in-house completely, correctly, versus hiring a third party? Mm-hmm. Well, and remembering that I don't think any of us want to put our citizens through a delay, which essentially would be a mirror of what we went through with an 8-year reval the last time. And looking at that in 29?
Yeah, I think you'd have to move it back 2 years.
Yeah, I don't think we want to do that either. So, but I do think we want to look, obviously we've got some interest in looking at both ways. I personally would like to know that information as well. What would it cost us to be there to be able to do it ourselves? And are we good with that? And then what would it cost us? Third party, and which one of those looks like the best for us?
Now, I will say I ballparked it early on when I was evaluating it, and it is about $2.5 million if we're going to do it.
Very similar. Pardon?
It's about $2.5 million if we're going to do it. It's very similar to what
is that annually
project. Because they're
big projects. You couldn't have staff here. You'd have to have them every year. So you take them 2.5 over 3 years.
Right. I break it down per revaluation project and sum up for each reval because that's the way that they would contract. So I could go apples to apples. Very, very similar cost if we're going to work with top quality. Now, again, I can get costs down. We've got 2.5 price revals. I can get costs down, but the price you pay is quality.
See, that's what I'm hearing. I want to hear Alamance County is top quality. That's what our county should expect.
Right.
We shouldn't have to hire top quality. We can hire that to help us, whatever. But we should be top quality. It's like, you know, we talk about...
Let's say that you've got a pizza restaurant. And across the street, you want to open a kind of a dinery burger joint. And you've got wait staff, and you've got cooks, you've got the maitre d', you've got everything in your pizza restaurant. And they're excellent. And you say, well, why can't your staff run both restaurants? I have enough staff for one restaurant. And they do pizza, they don't do burgers. Sometimes it won't matter, sometimes it will. And I'm saying that we got two restaurants, we need two staff, and I'd like them to know how to make a burger. We're making pizzas over here. That doesn't demean the pizza staff. That doesn't say the pizza staff isn't excellent. It's to say that I can't have one staff doing double job. I need double staff. And I can't have someone specialized for one thing doing another thing. So I think that our folks are excellent, but there's no way to stretch the people we have to do two jobs of two different sorts. We'd have to, again, double our appraisal staff, and we can do it. But again, the upfront times, it's going to push us back about 2 years. The cost, I think, is going to be very similar if we want similar quality.
Ms. Atkins, may I ask that we table this for tonight, come back to us at least our next meeting or maybe two meetings from now with actual numbers and recommendations?
Happy to meet
you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Forner. I keep saying, Mr., would you give us your rank?
Chief. I'm the Chief Deputy at Alamance County Sheriff's Office. And again, good evening. Commissioners, we come to you again tonight. As Lieutenant Dockery is passing out the proposal that we have on the bonus proposal for hiring. You all seen this about a couple of weeks ago. You all had some questions. As we said we would, we went to the county staff and got the county attorney to approve what was requested, which is a contract to put in this for a person to sign. The employee that comes on under this, if approved. We've also worked with county finance, county manager, on doing different things. As you look here, it says right now, this is what we have. We have actually 19, we're short 19 sworn and 51 detention. So it's a total of 70 people that were short at the sheriff's office. We're requesting a $10,000 sign-on bonus for 12-hour positions only, not 8-hour. Only the 12-hour positions, which will include detention and patrol. We were, in this process, we have to do an extensive hiring process because the state of North Carolina sheriff standards require us to do this. As far as a credit check, which is the first thing that we do when somebody puts a application before us, is because sheriff standards says that a person cannot have any outstanding credit issues because the sheriff's office is charged with serving those type papers to individuals that fail to pay their bills. That's the first thing. If they can pass that, then we start the background checks, which is included a criminal history check. Then we have to go to the polygraph. Then we go to the FMRT, which is a psychological evaluation. Then we drew the medical exam that they have to do, also drug screening, and that's all the vigorous process we do before we can, they have to pass all that before we can even hire them. And hire date is the date the sheriff appoints them as a deputy sheriff or a detention officer, and we have a service downstairs when we do that. We have took the recommendation at hire date, they will get a $5,000 initial money on the date of hire. Then the additional $5,000 will be given at the 14th month, $1,000, the 16th month, $1,000, the 18th month, $1,000, the 20th month, $1,000, and the 22nd month, $1,000. But they have to have an excellent review of their first year. They have to meet all requirements, pass all of the requirements that is set before them, have a good evaluation, have no demerits, have nothing to this. And we also talked about 80%, we would stop it, which 80% of 70 people is 56 people. Now you're going to ask me this question, Mr. Lashley. I'm prepared for you. Since we met with you last, which was about a month and a half ago when we brought this up, before the budget was passed, you asked me how many. Between now and then, we hired one today. Okay? So out of what we get on the system where you can put it in online, your application, or you bring it in, probably out of 200, Ms. Mantris, I have her here, she can correct me if I'm wrong, applications, this went out all over, probably out of that. We do referrals, a lot of them we cut out right at the beginning because of drug use. Ms. Pam, can't have nobody doing that. And they look at you and they say, well, what's today? And you say, well, today is Monday. Well, I did it last Thursday. Well, what'd you do? Well, I had cocaine. It's very sad. It is. But we can't take that person. That person's cut out of me. So we're looking at a possibility of right around 12 out of all that we have to work with due to our restrictions. Yes, sir, Mr. Talk.
Not on the application.
Those questions are on the applications. And when you have people that come in and cannot answer the questions, and you have to sit down with them and go back over it like you would a school child, or it's filled out half in blue, half in black ink, or it looks like a colored pencil it's been filled out in. That's what you, I'm not making fun, but that's what we see. That's what people are coming to do. Most of them are doing it to check off a box so I can say, so I get my unemployment, because they know we're going to turn them down immediately. So with this proposal, we have also done with the county attorney, we have brought up a contract. We have brought it up with the approval of the county attorney that looks good to do this sign-on bonus that they are required to pay this back and the amount of money. So out of all this, we have also already started trying to get it motivated. We've done a lot of things. We're working with county staff. We're doing the things. We're setting up to do to every place we can go to put on when they have fairs, when they have job fairs, when they have us, that we have recruiters there. We're also sending people to trainings that are also to do extensive background training, because you have to have that. You can't just send Jackie Fortner to go do a background training. That person has to be trained in that background. It has to be kind of the same person all the time. We have polygraph. We have another one in school, since we only have one polygraph examiner now, to expedite these processes. So with this, what will this do? Enlarge our application pool, motivate individuals to leave their current employer, and this is what we were looking for, laterals that are already the expense of the LET, the expense of the other stuff is already done. So we're taking them, they're experienced. We have to train them less time, because we have to train them with our paperwork, show them the boundaries of the county, that kind of stuff. But we can put them on the road quicker because they have already went through a vigorous process. We also want to increase the morale when people can't get off, because they're having to come back in, and we're having, the county's having to pay overtime for this, and they can't spend their money. What fun is that? So you don't have people calling in. That's what we want. We don't want them calling out sick when they're really not sick. They just want a day off. All of this that we have prepared for you tonight, we didn't do a presentation. We felt like that there's no need to do a presentation. You all can read or write. This is much easier and simpler. We've been here all night. And all five of these pages, we have actually started doing most of this stuff in preparation, hopefully, for your vote tonight, to get it prepared, to get it ready to go, so we can hit the ground running tomorrow. And that's what we want, sir.
Now, when you send names over to the county, those aren't applicants. Those are credit checks initially, is that correct?
Those are correct. That starts out with credit checks.
So those aren't people who are sitting out waiting for a job?
Those are not people that we're fixing to hire.
Right. Mr. Stevens has drafted a, what I think is an excellent contract, and thank you. It's several pages long.
Yes,
and I assume you've seen it. Have you seen it?
Yes, sir, I have. I have a copy of it right here in my hand. I apologize that he has put it in your packet, but I apologize that I didn't put that with that.
Oh, we have it.
You already have it. I found out that you already have it. But we work hand in hand with Mr. Stevens. Once a month, we work with him. We discuss things, and he hates it when my number pops up on his phone because I call him on a regular basis.
Mike point out in the contract, that one, pay and the bonuses are spread out, as you've indicated previously. Two, if they don't complete the entirety of the contract, then, and they quit early or discharge for misconduct or whatever, they have to pay those bonuses back.
That's the
pursuant to the contract.
Pursuant to the contract,
so
yes, sir.
Contract spells out day of hire, $5,000, and then on month number 14, that was they completed the entirety of one 12-month period plus an extra 2 months, then they get the 1 month one payment of $1,000.
That's correct.
And then at 16 months, an additional, so it's a total of $10 million, but they have to serve
I may quit today and join them on the outside.
Sincerely, it's been too long and I'm going
yes,
to
sir.
I notice I didn't say like Bob going to bed.
That's true.
But in any event, they got to serve the 2 years. One, or they may have to pay the money back.
That's correct.
And two, they don't receive it early on. I see that on page 4 of your handout, which you previously gave us and gave us another copy, you have other counties that are paying Durham County $6,000, Passaic County $5,000. You have Durham Police Department $10,000, Gastonia Police $15,000. So it really is a wide range, but when I did further inquiries with the sheriff and with you and with our county manager and so forth, that's not in 1 year. That's as in some cases up to 5 years. So
that's
it
correct.
Looks like maybe we're overshooting the number, but we really aren't.
No, we're not, sir, because as Ms. Pound said, we're the best. Alamance County needs to be the best, and that's the reason we're like this today.
County manager, do you have a suggestion?
I do.
Not at this time.
You know, we talked about this before, Jackie, about I understand the 80% of 70 that you're looking to get. I guess what I'm trying to do here is like I'm trying to, not trying to save some money, just trying not to spend some money that I don't really need to spend. You know, I'd like to go ahead and fund 10 positions. I know you know, if you could get to 55, that'd be awful good. But I've used this before with the sheriff, because sometimes you don't get as many folks as you need. And I'm thinking this is just an idea, now that the county manager's listening to you, that maybe we could fund 10 positions, and then when you get those 10 positions filled, all you got to do is pick up the phone and call us and say, hey, look, I need 10 more positions. It'd be a whole lot easier. Rather than me giving you $550,000 and get my fingers crossed that you get some people in those seats, just sort of do it piecemeal. That's just a recommendation. That's not written in stone anywhere.
And I had talked to Sheriff Johnson about 10 positions. And I talked to him this morning. He said, well, I want 80%. So I think he is agreeable to the 10, and as Mr. Lashley has indicated, he much would rather have the 80%, but I agree with Mr. Lashley. Let's start it out slow, and I really want you to fill those 10 positions and then come back to us. I don't like come back.
That's the reason the sheriff said what he said.
Yeah,
he don't believe in that either.
Yeah, but at the same time, because it's been so hard to recruit and retain, I agree with Mr. Lashley, and my initial settlement proposal with the sheriff was, let's go with 10. So that's not too far off.
And Jackie, another thing, you know, and Heidi, you can correct me if I'm wrong, we didn't budget for this in this last budget.
Right.
That's why we're talking about, you know, get through the month of July and you've got one, that's a good thing. But to pay for this program, we're going to have to use some lapsed salaries.
Yes, sir.
So that's what I was saying, you know. But you're close, you know. Today's the 15th. You're halfway there.
I think we need to look at a big question that we're not looking at is why. I mean, what I work with is like, why? Why is this happening? You know, when I started in 2021, basically, you can get all sworn and everything, the number's higher now. And I think, why is this happening? You know, I see Billy T. graduates and all this stuff. Wake County's budget for their county is over $2 billion. I sit beside Sheriff Rowley at the Governor's Crime Commission. And I got Sheriff Burkhead right on the other side. Now, there's something else just like my sheriff that they know Sheriff Johnson speaks so highly of him. But I went over these numbers last time we were talking about this. Durham County's got a big budget, much bigger than what we have. And there is no more cheerleader for law enforcement and the military than right here. And I mean that. But you know, a first year teacher makes $39,000. It takes her to teach or him 25 years before they make $55,000. And that's going to college, that's graduating, that's student teaching, and that's taking the praxis. And then staying if she can. We're 38th in the country with how we pay that part of our budget. So it's all kinds of stuff where you can look. We have to be safe no matter what. We just witnessed something so scary this weekend because of something happened. And thank God it didn't end like it could have. And I don't ever want that here. I don't want anything like that here. I don't want that anything like it anywhere. But we just raise taxes. Bill and I are big Parks and Rec. You know, we're talking about the alcohol we're selling can bring revenue. No, everybody needs more to really compete with what we've got with the inflation and my Lord, the price of groceries. And don't tell me inflation's going down when I go to Food Line. I'm not buying it. And I know your food that you have to pay for at the jail is outrageous. You know, because you have diets, you got to do the right thing. But we've given bonuses before when we've done through all that, and we still are struggling to get people to come do an amazing job. And when you tell me how many you've got, and I mean, somebody smoked weed last Thursday, like it's nothing, because that's what they do. And they come in and apply. You know, I'll never forget my son when he was in basic training. When he finally was allowed to call, he said, "They are dropping like flies down here because they don't understand what they signed up for. This is serious work." In a jail, on patrol, detectives, crime scene. Good Lord, it don't get any more serious. But it's just, you know, I don't want to steal from Burlington or steal from Chatham County because then that puts them in a bind. I want the best working for my county because this is what that officer wants to do. And we are higher than some counties. We've done salary surveys to show that. You have to pay people. You never pay people what they're worth when it comes to first responders. EMS is struggling. Everybody's struggling. 9 ambulances for the entire Alamance County. That's embarrassing. That really is. Because you don't have 9 emergencies that all happen at a convenient time, one time a day. So I think this has got to be really looked at more so. I couldn't vote on this right now if I tried because I don't know. And that's not because I'm not. For the man and woman that wears that badge, because I'll do anything. But this I don't know because I've seen how bonuses have not been that effective or we would not be this short. And I don't want people using us for this kind of money that the taxpayer's going to be paying for and they don't hang in there with us. I mean, I don't know. This is from all areas, it's just overwhelming to me. I just want to do the right thing by everybody because that's who I work for, everybody.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
You and Bill are talking about 10, setting a level of 10. The one problem I see in that, maybe several, but the one that pops up in my head almost immediately is if you limit it to 10 and they go out and they're working in a job fair, multiple job fairs in the surrounding counties, holding one in Alamance County, trying to bring people in. Are you going to tell you get 15, 20 people interested? How do you tell them that you're going to cut it off at 10 when you want 55 positions?
I cut it off at 10. Just allocating enough money for 10 positions at a time.
They can't go out and recruit if they don't know they're going to get the next 10.
Yeah, well, I just told them. You're going to get the next 10. If you come up
then
with 12.
What's the point?
Okay, $550,000, Steve. I don't want to have someone.
$379,000 in savings in overtime if we get them staffed up, plus lap salaries.
That's if. The man just told me last meeting that the most he hired last year was 7. Mm-hmm. So why are we going to go and fund $500,000? I don't have $500,000 to give away. Because we know, just like every other department, if you hand the money to them, it is going to go away. you're not going to be able to come and get it back. We can try. I'm actually doing him a favor by not funding it at $550,000. I'm doing it at 20% of that, which is $125,000. I can afford the $125,000, and if he gets 11 people, all he has to do is pick up the phone and call me, and we will have another $125,000 sitting here waiting for him. I just can't fund it all at the same time. That's irresponsible. You just got finished raising taxes, Steve. Why do you want to go ahead and take another $500,000 from the people and not knowing you're getting anything for it? That's all I'm saying. I'm willing to do it. I hope that Jackie and his captain go out and hire 25 people. I hope he calls me up tomorrow and says, I need some more money.
If he doesn't get them, we haven't spent it. What do you mean? If he doesn't get the people, we aren't spending it.
Steve, how many years have you been in government? You don't know how this game is played? What did the school system just do to you? Just got another how many, $5.5 million that you know as well as I do ain't going to be there where they say it's going to be. I'm not accusing anybody of anything, but I'm not so naive and gullible to think that I hand someone $550,000 that it's going to come back to me. I ain't that naive. I am not that naive. I'm more than happy to fund him 10 positions. And I'm going to hope and pray every day that he calls me and says, I need some more money. I got some more people on the hook. You're going to see somebody that's going to cheer you. It's going to cheer for you. But I'm not going to hand $550,000 out on bonuses that we don't know what's going to happen. And I'm glad that you think that if you do give it to them and they don't use it, that it's going to come back to you.
If they don't hire the positions, we haven't spent it.
You haven't spent it, but you give it to the department. Isn't that true, Heidi? Wouldn't we be giving that money to the sheriff's department, $550,000 to hire these people?
You'd be moving it out of their salary line, their lap salary line, designating
That's
it.
That's all I'm saying is take a bit of a step back and don't fund all of it, and let's see what comes back.
But it's coming out of one bucket in their budget and putting it in another bucket, Bill. It's the same dollars.
You may be right, Steve, but
I know our
fund balance is $7.5 million. That this is why you start taking money out of the fund balance at a $7.5 million clip.
Not the fund balance.
It's because she just got finished saying that it would come out of one system into another. All I'm saying
is one bucket in the budget into another bucket in the budget.
All right, go ahead. Give him $500,000, Steve. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'll make a motion. I'm going to move that we approve the $10,000 on bonuses as structured. That is $1,000 on day one, the second $1,000 on the 14th month, additional $1,000 on the 16th, additional $1,000 on the 18th, additional on the 20th, and the final $1,000 on the 22nd month, all to be repaid if the contract is not fulfilled for the 24 months, pursuant to the contract that Mr. Stevens has already outlined. I have no modifications to your contract, that these monies be paid out of lapsed salaries, or salaries that are sitting out there have not been used, and that the contract be a firm requirement along with the repayment if the contract terms are not met. I would also add that initially this be for 10 positions, with the availability of us looking at it at a later time if this board chooses to do so, but 10 positions initially. That's my motion.
Second.
Question, Mr. Chairman. Is it your intent that the motion, or that the program would go for this fiscal year and end
this
at the end?
This fiscal year.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. And I hope you get it, Jackie. I hope you get it.
I'm afraid of God, I do too.
I hope we figure out why.
So this is for hires made after July 1 or after July 15th, I guess, today.
Correct. And it's for 12-hour positions.
Great. And bring back in June?
Well, we bring it back into hires 10 employees.
Okay.
It meets those requirements of the 12-hour
positions. It's not ongoing beyond the fiscal year.
We reevaluate in June of next year.
Oh,
it's just for this fiscal year.
Now, Mr. Chairman, you just put in a caveat at the discretion of the board. It would be the next 10.
As to whether we add additional numbers.
Right.
I think it would have to come before this board each and every time we allot additional spots beyond the 10.
That goes back to my point. I presume we've got a motion and a second. It goes back to my point in the first place. Essentially, what they're hamstrung with is when they're out there trying to recruit, they have 10, an allotment of 10. If they get 10, if they get 15 people that want to, solid people that are already engaged in law enforcement that want to apply, they can only make the promise at that point to the 10.
Let me answer that. Mr. Fortner, once you go to a fair and have 10 names, what's the length of time to process?
Length of time to process is usually...
Usually it takes us about 4 to 8, sometimes 4 to 12 weeks. We do outsource the psychological, the medical, and the drug screening, and then we polygraph somewhat in the middle. And so the standards division has changed some of the requirements when it comes to the psych testing. It just started being a mandatory requirement as of January 1st, 2023. So we have to outsource this because we're not licensed psychologists.
And so, that answers the question. It's going to take at least 10 to 12 weeks at a minimum.
It's true.
And I'm not talking about the amount of time it takes them to process them. Okay. I'm just concerned that what we're going to do is hamstring them when they're out there trying to hire.
It doesn't go into effect, though, until they're sworn in or their first day on the job. Right?
We've got plenty of time to get them squared away.
It's not at the initial offer. They have to pass all of that screening first.
Well, to be perfectly honest, I hope you guys are right, and I hope it doesn't. I care enough about what they need to want to vote for it because I don't think there's any other option right now. But I hope we haven't hamstrung them by doing it.
Mr. Turner, do you have a question?
I don't.
Anybody else have questions? We have a motion and a second on the floor. All in favor of the current motion and second, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. I'm a no because of bonuses. I've seen how they're not effective, DSS, and it's nothing. God, I'm supportive of the men and women in law enforcement, but I just think it'll be all over again, and I just don't think this is the way to go about it. And that's just my opinion.
I want to make sure I know what the votes were. Carter was a yes. Oh, it goes 4-1.
Yeah.
Thank you. I didn't hear your vote. All right.
Thank you, Commissioner. Thank you. Thank you.
It's getting late now. That's the last item on our county attorney.
Mr. Chair, you asked a question earlier about historic landmark signs. I have an answer for the board on that. So the state's historic landmark structure actually has funding the state earmarks on an annual basis through the DOT, $100,000 for the ones the state provides and places. Our local program does not have such a funding earmark, but I will point out that in Section 4 of the resolution, it says that a suitable sign or plaque may be posted indicating that said property has been designated, so on and so forth. So I don't think there's a requirement that a sign be posted, and certainly not a requirement that the county pay for that sign. So I hope that answers that question about paying for the sign, and nothing further from me. Thank you, Board.
Thank you. Do you have anything else?
Nope. I think you've heard enough from me tonight. Thank you.
County manager.
I did follow up with the speaker that you heard tonight, Mr. Chandler, about the Meridian Waste. We had received $49,600 approximately for last year, which was prorated beginning in March. So very quick turnaround. The contract dictated $50,000 this current year. So that is what we have budgeted and feel certain that they will meet that with the revenue. And I have passed my phone number along to him as well. I also wanted to mention that we heard last week that the city of Burlington is pulling out of our co-located 911 center. So we are kind of assessing what that looks like going forward. Staff is getting together with Burlington leadership tomorrow to talk about the alignment of our CAD system moving forward. So I'll keep you posted as we know more on that.
And part of that is, again, they're refusing to even have the similar radio system in communication. It just, it's awkward at best.
Jeff, it's a city better than I
could. Anything else?
Nothing more for me, thank you.
Ms. Thompson.
I'm just glad that, I appreciate the alcohol situation. I really do. I take that real personally, what I work with. And I don't mean it's everybody, but it just hits me kind of hard. And I want our law enforcement to be solid. I'm concerned about my conversation with Jeremy. I don't want us to act like that we're not standards compared to somebody else. And I know he didn't mean that, and I'm not saying he did. I just want us to have a really solid tax department that can always handle what we need it to handle. And it's just so much, just so much. And we just have to think about everybody because, you know, Parks and Rec is important, EMS is important, DSS, everybody's important. It's like the body of Christ. Every role in that body plays a very important part that is absolutely necessary. And we can't make one think they're less than the other. I think I've told y'all, a good friend of mine just recently retired from the Marines. I went to Camp Lejeune. Oh my gosh, Craig, I was down there on that Marine base just wishing. And I went to Paris Island for him. I thought I was going to die. But anyway, a long time ago, when Evan was getting ready to go on service, I thought, oh, sniper, oh, EOD, all this, whatever. And he said, I'm going to tell you who the most important person in the military is during war. He said, the cook. And he did all the culinary. He says, because if you got hungry soldiers, you're in trouble. And that tells me that every role in whatever we have is just as important as anything else. It's like you can't pick between your children. You can, but you can't. So I just appreciate what we're doing, and I appreciate Jackie coming in here and advocating for the sheriff's department and the sheriff too. You have to fight for your agency, because if you don't, nobody will. And they're all so important. I pray for my nation, and I pray for my state, and I pray for my county, pray for my PTO, because right now we are so distracted that, you know, the devil's just wiping the floor with everybody. And we have got to stand up for what is right. You can have the right to do anything in this country, but unfortunately, it doesn't make it right. So I just hope we can get our eyes focused on what we need to and start really doing what America was created to be, the land of the free, because if we screw this up, we won't get it back. And I just the money involved in everything, greed is very powerful, fear is very powerful, and sometimes they're sisters. And so I just always want us to do the right thing by everybody, because we don't work for one department. We work for everybody that walks on the dirt now in this county. And I take that very serious.
Mr. Lashley.
I have nothing. Thank you.
Mr. Turner.
Same. Thank you.
Mr. Carter.
I think this this weekend brought this even more present in my mind. Been thinking about this since our last meeting. Thought about this particular verse of scripture a long time. And I know that it focused particularly on the Hebrew people, but I think it's germane to our own country as well. It's 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, and I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Folks, we need prayer in this country. We need prayer in Alamance County. That's the only way we're going to get this place fixed. Not working together, not trying to solve problems. We can disagree. We just disagreed tonight. I think we still have potentially solved a problem. That's the way this is supposed to work. We try to come up with the best solution we can. It may not be the one we want. But prayer and trying to do the right thing. That's a critical piece of what we have to do every day in government. Thank you.
And I'm in total agreement. By the way, the sheriff's bonus, I've never voted for a bonus in my entirety as a county commissioner until tonight. The sole reason I did it was our county attorney, Mr. Rick Stevens, drew a solid contract which does call mandate repayment of those bonuses if, in fact, they don't complete the entirety of the contract. So if they complete the entirety of the contract, we've done the sheriff's department, the citizens, and everyone a real positive thing. On the other hand, if they don't, we get the money back. And it can be enforced by lack of payment under the contract. It can be enforced by actually going after them and suing them if there's a deficiency. Solid contract, and that's the sole reason I voted for a bonus. Thank you.
Thank you.
I agree with Mr. Carter and everybody here. The government has got to return, not to just this county, but to the country. What happened Saturday, no rhyme or reason to that. And the lack of funding for Mr. Kennedy's campaign and Mr. Trump's campaign by the current executive branch is beyond my understanding or belief. How someone can be within 130 yards of the president or possibly, again, president of the United States and not be seen on a rooftop is just incredibly beyond my belief. And I think we're going to find probably part of that's going to be a really messed up individual. We need mental health. We need, and we haven't heard whether drugs or anything else were involved, but that'll be forthcoming. We've got to treat people that are sick. And additionally, we've got to provide proper security for those that are serving. Good night. Motion second, all in favor of adjourning, say aye.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Commissioner meetings typically occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham.
The first Monday meeting begins at 9:30 a.m. and the third Monday meeting begins at 6:30 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting will be broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about their schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our YouTube channel at www.youtube.com/AlamanceCountyNC or by clicking the YouTube link on the county website. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of this meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about the commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.